Oh, hey guys. Another episode of Mystery Titans Theater coming up here. So I just want to make sure that you know about our Patreon and all the great fun gifts we got here. You're going to see a link to it in the show notes here for this latest episode. We got a really fun one here for you. But if you do subscribe to our Patreon, you will find that, we got some great stuff, including our Lords of the Ring episode, the start of our New York trilogy is the first one we've given away so far. The first one we've given away for the month of June, and there should be another one, either a second part to our trilogy or a newer episode like I did with Marta Wesselhoff last show. Check out the Patreon. We're not just a live show, and if you haven't been checking out the live show, you should be checking that out too, because that's been really cool. It's Mystery Titans Theater, the Patreon. Check out the link in the comments. I've almost got this, you guys, seriously. Come on! That was it. We had 4 pellets left. I was really hoping for a big finish there. Anyways, enjoy the show. Bye. Oh, but give us your money. That's the big thing.
Hey, welcome back to a boogie-woogie bash of a night here at Mystery Titans Theater. My name is Travis Voloshin. I am joined, as always, by the guy who keeps bringing this beautiful worldwide wrestling to us, your friend of mine, Johnny Hedgepeth. Johnny, how are you?
I'm doing good. Looking forward to getting back into worldwide for taking a break, because I'm going to be not on the show in 2 weeks.
It's wild.
Grateful Dead, baby.
Yeah, we'll talk about that in a sec. But also, as always, with us, the Ken Burns of wrestling, the Chief J Historian, the only member of Brainbuster who's had his jersey number retired throughout the league, Kelly Nelson.
As it should. Number 69, of course.
That's what I was going to guess.
Nice.
Great to have you with us. Because this is a Sheik, Iron Sheik tribute, rest in peace. And we will get to that too. But Kelly's put together some stuff. We've had some input from Johnny, but also some input from what we're going to get to after this NWA stuff with our completing the quartet of the United Underworld, Robert Hawkins.
And watch it. Okay, sorry.
Oh, that's it. That's the intro for Robert, a belly to belly from Magnum. There you go.
I was today, retro 80s podcasting watch alongs, tomorrow the world.
Love it.
Actually, did add, if we need to have more United Underworld members, I did pick up both McFarlane Made Egghead and King Tut. So.
Nothing McFarlane hasn't done.
Yeah. How'd you track those down? Were they?
Target.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, they're all Target exclusives, along with, they've gone to the low level of now Pink Cowl Batman, if you remember that episode.
Wow.
Cool.
Cowboy Ron Bass and J.J. Dillon.
J.J. Dillon is actually one of the very few 80s wrestling figures from Mattel I don't have. They made a J.J. Dillon finally. And sadly, he was one of the ones who had to buy a whole set to get pieces of, so now he's like $100.
Right. He comes with like what's his name's Paul Elring's dummy's right arm, probably, or something, right? what's the name of that guy? Rocco. Yeah,
if he did Rocco, he was part of a build a wave with Paul Elring, and I don't know what to make of this.
Yeah,
but the figure that came with Rocco, I never bought it, was China. So you can make your own jokes there about China and a wooden puppet.
And this puppet's art.
That would have been a movie she would have made eventually if she didn't die.
Oh boy.
That writes itself. I don't need to help.
So Ron Bass, we haven't seen him.
Not yet. We're about to see some new faces. Ron Bass had been there, left. I think he was in Memphis for a while, and now he's back with JJ.
Now, when does, because I just recently watched about 2 months ago all of the October, November, and December episodes of this and Saturday Night and Starrcade. It's kind of just a project. When does he split up from Dillon? Because he's feuding with him by Starrcade.
The baby face turn happens before Starrcade.
Our boy, all right. No bull. The bull is ready to unleash the rage.
The rage.
That's that arm.
He's got the Samoan spike there.
There's our buddy.
Yeah, Billy still hasn't turned back.
Did he do two runs as coming? Because I thought he went back to being tie-dye in Florida.
He did.
He comes back to Crockett and he's back to Kung Fu.
Basically, rewind the tape and start over with the turn back.
Yeah, and with the turn in Florida, he exercises the demons by going to the desert and all that shit. Here, he just shows up. And Dusty Rhodes takes credit for it by saying that he just insulted him in the locker room, and that was all it took. He's like that Dusty walks by him. He's like, "Excuse me, I thought Superstar Billy Graham was here."
Right. He said that.
I wonder how the Mags dealt with that bit of kayfabe breaking, if you want to call it that.
You know what? I don't remember them mentioning
Earth 2, Billy.
Yeah.
This is awesome, though. Yeah. We saw this last time a while back, right?
We must have. There's been so many.
Yes. Because so the first.
No. This is different. Now we see
this is a new one. Oh, okay. Yep.
Dick Slater.
Oh.
Dirty Dick Slater is back.
That's when the girls go out at night. It's drinks first, Dick Slater.
Dirty Dick Slater.
Hey, Denise in the credit. Dusty taking credit for something? Shocking. Great to have you back, Denise.
I showed some Paul Jones recently to a friend of mine who's a classic wrestling and Doctor Who fan. His response was to say, so at one point, Patrick Troughton and John Pertwee had a kid.
Yeah.
Because it's pretty much what looks the like master. The rest is like the other.
Speaking of action figures, it looks like the way what's his name was holding his hand there. It looks like sometimes you get those action figures that always are just stuck in that karate chop like that. You could never put a gun in that hand.
Well, there was a G.I. Joe character later that looked like Billy Graham. He was a Cobra guy.
Gumbo? I thought you were thinking of Gumbo.
No, he had a cape and maybe a monocle too.
Oh, Dr. Mindbender?
Mindbender, that's right. Yeah.
Happy to hear that, Denise. That's awesome.
Yeah, but Billy Graham never had a swank monocle.
No, that's what he was missing. I shouldn't have went the kung fu route. I went the aristocrat.
Or maybe a little chocolate peanut butter action, kung fu aristocrat.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I want to hear Billy Graham do the aristocrats joke.
It'd involve a lot of steroid injection and weird body parts.
Yeah, it'd be steroids and shit and incest.
And it all takes place in the desert.
No, it's got to be in the talent agent's office. That's integral to the joke.
Right, of course. Well, I mean, the performance itself. Nah, I don't know.
Right. Yeah, so like Dick Slater, I guess, had been a baby face, was kind of part of this Paul Jones stuff, and he's been gone for 8 weeks.
Yeah, just
and they haven't mentioned him once. So, this is when I really got into Dick Slater. This was my introduction to him, and I thought Dick Slater was fucking cool.
Okay,
and then he's here for a little bit, and he's gone. Because he's Dick Slater, he's a crime and sports fucking subject. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know much about him.
And goes to Mid South, is heel again, and he has a great run in Mid South, feud with Jake Roberts and other guys. Then he's one of the many who go to Vince from Watts around '86, and Vince gives him the gimmick, the Rebel. Dick Slater, and he was a baby face who came down to the ring waving the Confederate flag.
Right.
It sucked.
It totally sucked.
Oh, really? And
it's always that was the first Dick Slater I knew. So ever after kind of painted him as like a guy that I didn't really pay much attention to because of that.
No, I had the same experience. I mean, there's a whole list. I remember he was around for maybe 6 months. I think he had one Saturday night event, lost to Morocco. And he's one of those guys, like, it wasn't until really, like, I'd heard things about that he was good starting in the 90s. But then it's like when somebody told me in, like, 98, oh, you know, Buddy Rose was a great worker. Well, all I remember is the blowaway diet as a kid.
Right.
Like, there he was, Buddy. And then it's like, Oh, well, never mind. Actually, was Vince to screw him up too. Oh, okay.
All right. Yeah. Denise said it made no sense for Slater to be a babyface in New York or even the East Coast, not just New York.
Yeah, it that was the.
Oh, was that?
That was a jobber about to get fucking clobbered by the barbarian.
Barbarian's like, okay, we're ending this right now.
Please don't try moves more complicated than you know how to do.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I was saying, was this been before or after? What is the name of the movie? I can never remember this. Dirk Benedict is the manager, the promoter of Roddy Piper and Tonga Kid.
Body Slam.
Body Slam. Yeah.
Body Slam. Oh, was this been before?
Sounds like a future boxing day.
Well, this is 85. I think the movie came out in 86. So who knows?
Yeah. It was filmed, way before it came out, I think. But I don't know exactly when.
Barbarian was kind of ageless, dude. Think about it. This is 85. He's still kicking it 96 in 97 in WCW.
Somebody threw a pine cone into the ring. How's my karate chop, Paul?
Black belt over a t-shirt. Yeah. Not too imposing.
I think they're really playing into the eventual turn because it's all... Dusty was like, I looked over at him sitting there all just gray and bland. And I said, So we're just going to see him get grayer and blander and completely jacked to the gills on steroids too.
Embrace the beige. That's wearing a t-shirt that says that. That's where Cena stole the.
This match has been way too long.
Yep.
Yeah.
Like I said, that is something with these Crockett shows. Sometimes jobbers just get in front, they get them in a front face lock, and there we go. We got time to fill.
The Don Morocco special.
I'd rather watch Barbarian do it than Black Bart, though. So there's that.
Yeah, for sure. No, I love Barbarian usually.
And what time was Worldwide on when you watched it back in the day, Johnny?
If I remember correctly, it was either 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock Saturday afternoon on channel 17 out of Philadelphia.
Okay. That's the same time Superstars was on in Boston for at least like 86 to maybe 95 or 96.
Yeah. WWF was on earlier in the day on the Philadelphia UHF stations, and it would be on WOR at 5 o'clock.
Tommy Young getting right in there as he did.
Yeah. And Robert, we just had, like, with that, even without cable, we had so much fucking wrestling because we got the UHF stations from New York and Philadelphia.
Okay.
And just, there was two WWF syndicated shows. There was this, there was AWA, which was Pro Wrestling USA. There was World Class, Classic World Class, UWF, California Championship, just nonstop.
That's awesome.
Plus the MSG network.
And MSG once a month, yeah. No, that was when we got
Prism, too, right?
That's, yeah. Never had Prism, but...
you didn't pay for it?
That was, it wasn't even available, and we wouldn't have paid for it anyway. But when me and my dad did get cable, MSG network, like, one Tuesday a month, I think it was just like a free fucking pay-per-view. It was awesome.
Mm-hmm. I'm still so jealous of people who grew up with that wrestling lineup.
There it is. That's it.
Yeah,
I grew up with Superstars.
Barbarian ballsack pin.
Like, that was it.
Man, people are throwing all sorts of avocados at the ring today.
It's probably what the average person in Carolina thinks Tongan people survive on out of an avocado diet.
They never mentioned that he's from Samoa. He's from parts unknown. He's a barbarian. He's from, you know, Conan's land. Iberia.
Distance. Right? Yeah. Crimea.
Crimea,
or,
that's it.
Or no. It was the Hyborian
Gilbert
age.
M. Lefkowicz.
Springfield, Mass. Wow, okay.
Gilbert M. Lefkowicz. That guy. The worst.
I didn't know that.
That means I was only... Because we had a silly as a sound,
Thanks, Lefkovich.
But I wasn't allowed to turn it west, only east.
Oh, so guys, this is a little different. Every one of these we've watched so far was in the Philadelphia market, probably on YSP. Now we're getting one from Virginia.
Interesting. That's cool. Maybe we'll get some commercials. The unpredictable Dick Slater, and then you'll
see World Television title. Oh yeah, he's not dirty. Yeah, he's not
unpredictable.
Yeah, he's not dirty Dick.
Crazy.
Here, he's unpredictable.
There's only one unpredictable in wrestling, and it's not Dick Slater.
No, that's why he got that stupid rebel gimmick. When he went up there, he's I'm unpredictable Dick Slater. It's like, we've already got an unpredictable. He's a legend.
That's the motto, girl. Predictable drinks first, unpredictable drinks later, or Dick Slater. To base anything on, but you see, this individual has everything to gain and nothing to lose, because to secure a victory over Buddy Landell would certainly catapult him. It's good we're seeing more of Landell now too.
Landell's getting a big push, dude, and then he fucks it up. Because with the
nature boy, I prepare him. We never wash, rinse, repeat for his career.
Exactly.
Yeah, I just started watching also Smoky Mountain from the beginning, and he had two runs in that. The one everybody remembers is 95, but he had another run where he was mostly feuding with Tim Horner. Pretty unmemorable stuff.
Do you remember, I think it was like 95, 96, he was a last-minute substitute for someone on a WWF pay-per-view? I'm gonna keep ringing the phone. And was on Raw the next night, and he was doughy and everything, but he's still good. And the story was they're like, all right, maybe we'll keep a buddy around. And this time he slipped on the ice and fucked his leg up. Again,
going right in against Magnum. No luck.
No luck. Predicting the Tully. That one wasn't even his fault. Let's bring in now Nikita Koloff, a special. Yeah, here we go. Here's my man. Against the unpredictable Dick Slater. It's so funny. Did you guys watch the Magnum Dark Side?
We started it. We didn't get to finish it. But it's funny how they really play up. Like his accent more than. But we'd seen him before not doing it so much.
Oh, I've seen Nikita shoot interviews. He sounds like Midwestern Mick
Foley. Yeah. But I thought in the interviews that we've seen, he hasn't been using.
Here we go.
Oh, wow.
Pat Tanaka is about to make. We're getting debuts. We got Bass, Slater, and this is the debut of Pat Tanaka.
Miami Vice.
Yep. Yeah. That is prime 1985.
Now, Pat Tanaka, you will never see him win a match, by the way. He's getting this big introduction. He's like the top of the jobbers all the entire time. He was my favorite jobber because he's fucking awesome.
He's being introduced as a top contender for the junior heavyweight.
Yeah, well, that was it. They were bringing in guys, maybe thinking of doing something with Denny Brown in the junior title, and they didn't. And so Pat Tanaka ended up jobbing on TV every Saturday. And there's a master in the ring right now. Cowboy Ron
Bass with that black glove on his right hand. Yeah, they were like getting that glove over.
Oh, yeah. That's one of his... he's done that in all the territories.
He didn't have it in WWF though, for whatever reason.
I think that's something we could make work. Hey guys, at Boom, a black glove on one of the younger kids. Yeah, it's a good idea.
You got to do it like this black glove though. The DiBiase black glove was always kind of stupid.
Yeah.
Coming up soon. My podcast next episode will have a detailed review of Nicole Matthews versus Amira from Boom Wrestling. That was awesome. Our new school selection.
Awesome.
Hey, cool.
Yeah, I'll check that out for sure. Yeah, I mean, Nicole is amazing. Her and Artemis are on a tour right now. She's doing a lot of the states. Got a t-shirt out that's the Redemption Tour.
Yeah, I saw that.
Outlaw Ron Bass was responsible for the one and only time. My friend Will's had a number of girlfriends over the years. One of them named was Emily. She was a chemistry teacher, if I remember correctly. She had no knowledge of pro wrestling whatsoever. And one day he and I were just visiting, and she came back in, and we were watching, I think, like Superstars of 88 on YouTube or something. It was Ron Bass. And she just watched it. And she goes, oh, so wrestling is like gay cowboy porn. Oh, okay.
What's up, dudesters? Castle Crossface in the house. Good to see you, bud. You
mentioned porn and fucking Crossface shows up, man.
There's our guy.
Politics.
Dude, I remember being seventh row floor seats at the Civic Center, but right on the aisle. And oof.
That was a night. That's got to be it. Oh, really?
When Ron Bass walked by me, that was one of those. I didn't realize how big this man was from television. He walked by me. I was like, Jesus Christ, this guy's a fucking giant. He's a huge man. The American Drape Dusty Rhodes. With huge tights, too. I always like that. No, you can't call those shorts. They go all the way up. Also,
we're going to have a video. The double XL t-shirt he's wearing.
Oh, we're getting the video from Nikita and Ivan tonight. Oh, this is good. This is a good one.
This looks like this was a hockey arena. You could see the scoreboard or hanging at the top, and you could see period on it.
Oh, yeah. I don't know. I guess, you know what? But it's definitely in the South, though.
Or so. Basketball. Could be a basketball.
But they're called quarters in basketball.
Yeah, but sometimes you'll see old scoreboards that would call them periods and stuff.
Well, Virginia's still somewhat north, though, isn't it? Like right on the... Well, it's on the line, right?
It's
that's
close.
Where the South starts, is it's, Virginia, as far as I understand it.
Trust
or
me,
is it South, Maryland?
No, the South started in South Philly and and Southern New Jersey, where I've lived. Trust me.
Really?
Delaware's the South, dude.
Crossface says Ron
Bass. The
Briscoes?
Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah, I always wondered about that. They are hillbillies.
Crossface saying Ron Bass is sporting the latest in active grandpa sportswear.
Yeah.
It comes with the glove, but that's more for my carpal tunnel.
Ron Bass
endorsing carpal tunnel, like
he could be the new
afterwards. That'd be pretty good.
The new Wilford Brimley, who's gone now. I'm Ron Bass to hear talk about your diabetes.
He's dead, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Bass or Brimley? Bass or Brimley?
Brimley.
Or both?
Brimley. I'm pretty sure Ron Bass is alive.
No, I think you're right, Joe.
Yeah, the Magnum episode, I mean, it was Dark Side, sure, but it was definitely the most non-disturbing lights.
Bass died 6 years ago.
There we go.
Really? Wow.
Yeah, because I remember reading his obit in the Observer, and it had like great detail about what he did in the 70s. That I'd never heard of when he was part of like this gone? Like gangster family, the Bass family with Ma Bass.
Right.
Oh, he had brothers. It sounded really awesome.
Ron Bass. Yep.
I like that. And then keeping it on afterwards, and even his own manager can't pull him off.
No. JJ's pretending to pull it off.
I see.
Yeah.
Are you questioning the humanitarianism of JJ Dillon?
That's what makes it so funny. JJ's like, I can't do anything about it, ref.
And tries his best. It's nothing but disrespect.
For a second, I thought you were calling out the whole thing. You know, he's just pretending to put that on him, Travis. Wow. Johnny, how long have we been doing this, man?
Hey, he's the master of the double thrust.
Oh, my God. That's what you need on a t-shirt.
Legend only continues to grow. Dick Slater, why is he dressed up like friggin' Arn Anderson?
Solving a mystery.
He's solving a mystery. He's helping Jimmy Valiant out, baby, who can't talk. Here, turn this up. This is good.
Now, a lot of things have happened. Paul Jones has got a broken arm. Paul Jones wants to call us a bunch of animals. Well, thanks, because we are what we are, and we're going to be that way because you are making us that way, Paul Jones. Drop me on my
head. That looks a little bit like Glenn Jacobs.
Paul
pile drive me, put me out of professional wrestling for some time now, and now you're trying to do the same thing to this man. Can't say anything.
Don't touch it. Delicate. Yeah.
He drops.
See, he's auditioning to be
out for another 2 months.
Yeah.
God, I want to suck your dick.
You're nothing but an egg-sucking dog. You gotta wear the hat.
Egg-sucking.
Really, right in front of everybody
dick
here.
Sucking.
God, man, I'm so horny right now.
Honky either. Honky, wow.
Who'd you call a honky, honky?
Myself, superstar, and boogie woogie. You gotta deal with us now. You gotta deal with us now. If Jones talking about dogs, you're going to be running like a scalded dog when we get done with it. Because every time you turn
like scalded
around,
dog.
Me and the boogie will be coming in.
He's jerking, off right off camera. Right now. Boogie Woogie's not wearing any pants. He's rock hard. He's about to pop right now all over David Crockett's microphone.
There he goes.
There we go.
Here, I'm bringing out the chalk.
War.
Yes. How could you not fall in love with Jimmy Valiant if you're 15 and me? All right. Oh, boy.
Here we go.
Grenades.
Headband versus headband.
Yes. We will be experiencing the slow downfall of Don Grenade. We saw it in the promo he gave a couple weeks ago. He was just didn't look well.
He's nothing without Sergeant Slaughter.
Is this his last run anywhere?
No, he goes to Vince and is an undercard guy for
really?
I think longer than you would.
Was it before this? I thought that was early.
He was definitely before when Slaughter came back in 83. Kernodle came with him, but they didn't do anything with him as a tag team, of course. I'm sure
he showed up when Tim Horner was bouncing around there.
Yeah,
and everything.
Yeah, he very well could have.
Y'all been kernodling with that lady down the street? Because I do not recommend that.
Well, he was just in the back seat at the drive-in doing a little kernodling, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, that's what she was saying.
According to Cage Match, this run was his last run, actually. He's
really?
In Crockett all through December of 86, and then other than a handful of reunion shows, that's it. Yep.
I'm misremembering. Who's the other jobber here? I like his look.
Name is Ben Alexander.
My name is Dr. Fraser Crane.
Exactly.
Well, he looks like Eugene.
That's why you're going to see him. A bit.
Bald on top.
If you go by, I think we've got the Crane brothers involved a couple times in wrestling.
Oh, this is
matches.
Definitely Fraser. Look at this. Yeah. This is season 7. No, this is season 13 Cheers Fraser with long hair and the beard.
Yes.
Which I thought was
his best
look. I
don't think
it has
13 seasons.
Whatever. The last season.
the later ones.
Which when they spun off Frazier, I was immediately disappointed because I thought he looked so much better with the longer hair and the beard. I thought he looked great. Sam, who do you think I look like? The guy on the can of deviled ham? He's like, no, Sigmund Freud, no, the father of modern psychology. He's like,
he gave all that up to sell ham.
No ham? Well, he had to earn a living, Sam. Like anyone with 3 stars on the back of the tights.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
No one's rocking it like Randy Savage or Jimmy Valiant, but Frazier, he's got it going on.
Hey, Frazier.
We got the idea from Bill Dog.
Oh, wow. It's pretty ugly, but I like that that's what his finisher. Yeah. I like the idea. I like the idea, Kernodle. It's the thing about Kernodle. He sounds good on paper. Once you canoodle once, though, it's like it's not as good in person. Hey, so I just got canoodled the other day. Oh, really? How was it? Not that great.
She put her finger way too far up my ass.
All right. I was really trying to just leave a lot open to
I'm yes ending you.
Like a bull, he never quits. Tell us what that special
message yes, sir. That he had for us from the
Kremlin, but he wouldn't tell us. He said, oh, here we go. Check it out. Check this shit out. This is one of the greatest things you'll ever see.
Go out and get an interview from him and Nikita. He said no, that he would bring us the tape of that very important announcement. All right, he's brought it to us.
They've been teasing the bull all night. Where's he? What?
They always put the bull in the middle of those things. This is the video they've been teasing for a couple of weeks. Here we go. Check it out. Check it out.
Ah.
Mm.
The silence is deafening.
Literally.
Yes.
This is the beginning of the
back. Someone's about to get decapitated, it feels like.
Nikita, my nephew, has been chosen by the Kremlin to be the world's champion. And I'm also very proud to announce that I've been chosen by the Kremlin to be Nikita's trainer and coach. Now, these cameras have been sent over from Russia, from the Kremlin. These weights have been sent over. This is private workout, secret workout. And it's not for anybody.
I was going to say, just like some other gym members kind of gets over. You guys done with this?
Kremlin wants you to see. They say the champion has grown soft, has been living too high in life, drinking and partying too much. And you're going to
yes.
find out.
Like I was doing in real life at this time.
It is only a matter of time. And you will see that Nikita will be
just to do this promo.
Vodka that the Kremlin calls it in gold.
That's so awesome. That's just Rocky IV, dude. It's fucking great.
I think the black wall really helped.
It hasn't even been out yet. What is it, in May of 85?
Yeah, it came out in the summer, I think, 85.
With Ivan Koloff, he's a monster. Oh, my goodness. Also, two-thirds of the world.
And he's even playing it more Rocky, and he's like, the champion is soft now. Playing right. into... Hey, woman. Hey, woman.
Wait a minute. He's going to be Drago and Ivan's going to be Clubber Lang.
Uh-huh. Hey, woman.
That would have been quite a tag team.
Why don't you come back to my apartment and show you what Kremlin Real Man is all about?
Kelly, Johnny, we got to see Spider-Verse. Kelly, did you get to see it yet?
No.
It is awesome. It's great.
Yeah, now that I know it's part one and two, I may wait on that one.
Hmm. Well, you got to see it on the big screen. The visuals are something else.
Yeah, that's just it, dude. It's a movie-going experience like I've never had because it's so original. And seeing it on the big screen was just amazing. I was like, yeah. I've got like a 100-incher here on the wall.
Not quite, but we've been to one movie since pre-pandemic, and it was The Many Saints in Newark. There was two other people in the theater.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I know. It was disappointing as a big Sopranos fan.
Yeah, me too. I watched it on HBO, and I couldn't wait, and I watched it, and I was like, okay.
I know.
Sometimes you can't recapture the moment.
Exactly. Godfather 3.
Yeah.
Many examples.
It just, to me, I was like, the main character, who I can't remember, was not someone I ever gave a shit about. They talk about him, but I'm like, it's this guy's history? Give me young
Christopher's
fat
dad. Yeah.
Christopher's, I don't care about Christopher's dad. Give me more of his. Okay, Gandolfini's kid playing young Tony. Give me more of that. I liked all of that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that was the way to introduce him there. Maybe they'll do more with it.
I don't think so. And the timeline was all screwed up from the original series. Yeah.
Just told our mutual friend Ted that I was going to do a watch along with him for the first time this summer.
Of Sopranos?
Yeah, I've never watched it.
Really?
Yeah. Oh,
same with my wife. My wife neither. So we're both like, yeah, okay, let's do it.
Yeah,
you'll love it.
Yeah, it's well worth it.
Cool. Yeah, no, I hadn't heard. It's one of those things, right? One of those big blind spots.
Well, when it was first out in Canada, you couldn't watch it because we didn't have Showtime or whatever. HBO. Yeah. So we had to just rent the DVDs of the seasons, and that's how I watched it originally.
People used to subscribe to HBO just for Sopranos and then cancel their subscriptions when the season was over.
And yeah.
That was something that happened in the States.
Yeah, because it was the first. Yeah.
That first season was, by the end of that first season, it was, especially in New Jersey, it was a goddamn cultural phenomena.
Yeah.
No, I bet.
Basically, what I do with Disney every time is on Star Wars show, same thing.
Yeah, I mean, we keep Disney, but there's some that we subscribe and cancel and resubscribe.
I'm over again. I'm looking at all my subscriptions, and I'm like, I don't ever watch Disney. I don't ever watch it.
Like, we still kind of have cable. Like, we're looking at all these things. Like, how much of this do we still need?
But
just a live sports,
wow,
man.
My family
uses the Disney app far more than I do. So, I'm just fine. Here we go.
But that Stan Lee doc is awesome.
Jack Kirby's son had a few things to say about it.
Yeah.
Really? What did he say?
This is the same old shit. Stanley is just another Stanley taking credit for everything when he.
Oh no, no! I'd say by the end, like, they really leave it open to they honor Kirby and they honor Ditko for sure.
Yeah, it's definitely more balanced than your usual Stanley love fest thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man, that 87 conversation is crazy. They start off being super sweet to each other, but it turns.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, that was during a period when Kirby was fighting to get his art back. It was pretty ugly at the time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We'll be right back with more right after these commercial messages. Love that 50 years crest.
Yeah. It's the Marvel style. I'm the idea guy. Jack writes all the words and the pictures, but I got the ideas.
Yeah, they kind of play it like yeah. they play actual him voice of him saying that, and they don't play it like he's the authority on that. No, it was pretty good. And
then listen to this. I'm sure I'll end up watching it, man.
And it finishes. It ends up being like super inspiring by the end.
Yeah,
like,
it's well made. Super moved. It's made.
Yeah, yeah. I just read that book a year ago, so I need a little time. Mm-hmm. Does it get into the tragedies of the end of his life?
No. It's pretty positive.
How much Kevin Smith is in this thing?
There's zero. Really? It's not like a documentary where they interview other people.
It's just
clips of Lee and telling his story.
They play his own words, right? Yeah. Like through the whole
different,
thing.
From
and
different
occasionally
you
hear Joe Simon. Occasionally
Jack
hear
Kirby.
Yeah.
Flo Steinberg.
What do you
secretary.
Call that style? That's a certain style of documentary when they only use.
It's my favorite style.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to say, what was that style of shirt that Magnum was wearing? Because I remember that look. That was an 80s fucking look. Which is no
stranger. Yeah, the weird, like, pieced together type shirts.
Yeah, I remember that fucking look.
I had at least one or two when I was in elementary school.
Good, stick a fucking Panama hat on top of
Panama hat. Oh, Magnum with Panama. They're just passing around the same Panama hat that Arden brought in first.
What am I, remember those caps that were hot?
It's the promo hat, baby. Put on the promo hat.
I think they were considered Australian, and they were like a cap, and they had flaps on the back of them.
Oh, that, yeah, like,
you remember
yeah,
those?
It was like a French Foreign Legion type
sort of sort of yeah
yeah I remember it,
man.
It
we mentioned the
popular.
Foreign Legion so much on this show.
Yeah, briefly popular in the 80s, I remember.
I had one.
I may have had one too. Just pile around your waist
for whatever reason. Tully Blanchard. Crossface says he remembers when the weightlifter gloves became a thing. Seen before.
What's mine? Yeah, the Magnum Dark Side was, it was tragic what happened, but here's hats off to Magnum. Magnum was a serial cheater on his first wife, okay? And they get into it. he kept it up after the accident. Okay. So he's half paralyzed, and they do a recreation, one of those shadowy recreations of crippled Magnum TA getting caught fucking some broad.
That's insane. So
hilarious.
Like, he's a legendary. That's a cocksman. That's a
cocksman. I mean, yeah, that is. I mean, fuck. More power to Magnum, I guess.
Well, it was also really shitty because his wife was taking care of him.
Right.
At the time. So, I mean, right. It was the worst thing about Magnum. It was the only bad thing about Magnum TA was that story. Everything else was like, no, Magnum was a good dude.
Bill was banging the rat.
Here we go. It's Tully Dusty, baby.
This is from one of the major arenas, probably.
Probably, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if this is Greensboro or...
Greensboro, the Omni.
Maybe Greensboro, Omni, Roanoke.
Baby doll on the outside.
Yeah.
Cross, good tackle. Like she's a Zatanna.
Yeah.
Right.
Dusty blocks it. I'd like to see baby doll in fishnets, you guys.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're talking.
Black Canary.
Oh my God. I saw what happened on Rampage last night, Johnny, and I could hear you throwing the chair across the room, seeing Aubrey Edwards wrestling.
I wasn't going to get into it, but one of the things I've been enjoying on AEW was the Mark Briscoe, Jeff Jarrett, Sanjay, except Sanjay, Jay Lethal, all those guys. They're like everything Jarrett, I like watch on them because it's been great. And now I can't fucking watch it.
Okay. Dang. I thought that would be enough to... No. As soon as I saw that, I'm like, oh no.
No, I saw the still shots, you know? Yeah. And I was like, yeah, I did too. Get fucked. Get out of here. Fucking stinks. Now these two men have been going at it for a long time. Ruined my favorite fucking thing on a TV show. I have to fast forward through half of it anyway.
Which, by the way, I'm wondering if anybody watches that anymore.
Yeah, it hasn't been that good. But I'm interested about what happened tonight. Like, that got me interested again.
Oh, dude, I'm recording. I'm going to watch it right
now. Yeah, I'm going to watch it when we're done here, too. I got it later. Yeah. But I've
seen clips already. I'm like, all right, so... all the actual wrestlers are on this show. Is that what am I to understand? Is that okay? Mm-hmm. Good. I'm gonna watch this one.
Maybe that's what they're gonna present it as, kind of brand split kind of thing. That might work for them. That would be good.
Dude, tonight is the six man. That's
I can't tell if he's dancing or if he's losing consciousness.
Yeah, no, he's woozy. He's woozy.
Yeah.
Lila column A, Lila column B, baby. But Joe and Punk are in the ring tonight for the first time since I was
ROH.
At the legendary trilogy. I was me and Danzo and my ex-wife were at the third match in New Jersey. It's fucking awesome.
That is right. Tully was the best crossface. Love Tully.
You got FTR. Fucking Miro, Andrade. Yeah. I'm like, okay, I'm watching this one, definitely. And they get, here's a stupid, they get fucking Elton John Saturday Night's All Right for fighting. And I'm like, that's fucking great. Well done. I give Tony Khan a lot of shit. I was like, well fucking done. And then I stumble into a thread, a DVD of all places, with three assholes arguing about the choice of this fucking song. Like, it's a 50-year-old song. It's not
too
even
old,
relevant.
Man.
I was like, go fuck yourself. That's a great choice.
The casual fans won't get it.
Okay, I'm like, are you fucking out of your mind?
The casual.
That's the typical argument on Twitter, or like the bad faith argument. Right, why do you have Vicata? Nobody knows. No Americans know who Vicata is.
Oh, yeah. I'm excited for that pay-per-view for sure. Yeah, I'm hosting. That's the first pay-per-view I've hosted in forever, man.
I'm considering it. $50 is a lot, but I'm considering it.
Big Z's covering it.
But a personal dream match of mine, though, for years.
Yeah.
Danielson and Okada.
Oh, no. Dusty's foot's on the rope.
Make your way into town.
Going to be there the following week.
I know. The next week. And that's what, that's going to be it's talked about Johnny being away. I don't want to interrupt if there's something big coming here.
There is. Tully just won the TV title back from Dusty Rhodes.
Awesome.
Baby Doll gave him a foreign object, clocked him. Tommy Young was groggy. Dusty's foot was on the rope. It didn't matter. Typical three count.
Dusty finish. Well, not the actual switch, though.
Foot on the rope and a foreign object.
Got to protect Dusty.
So
that's fine. That's how good guys lost back then.
So next week, Johnny, you're going to see Dead and Company. So
yeah, I've seen Dead and Company, the final tour. Yep.
But we've been planning to do a Canada Day with our buddy James Hamilton, the Frightful Four.
No Americans allowed. Next
but
time.
Kevin Lyon is in town, so he's going to join us. Yeah, so it might be we might do a in person. Travis and Kelly and Kevin and I might get together and sort something out. We're going to figure it out, but. I just thought.
Yeah, I don't know if Kevin. I'll be there for a person, but we'll see.
Okay, we'll see.
Okay, Baby Doll looks like Al Jolson in the Jazz Singer here. Yeah. Right
oh my gosh.
What the fuck?
Mammy,
don't you know me? Don't you know me, Mammy?
Oompa Loompa Doompa Dee.
Jazz Singer born in the 80s. Jim Crockett figured it out.
Yeah, I usually like
it's
Baby
Doll.
They overdid it. Luck.
You gotta know when to hold. All I see is a damn fool. I thought you was bringing home a white boy. All I see is a damn fool.
She's Soul Man. She's Soul Man in reverse.
Okay. So I'm having the Phillips Brewing and Malting Company. Look at this. Cat Kiss Prickly Pear Mojito. Go say this. So I was thinking if Kevin was here.
Great design.
This is out of here. This is really different, though.
Isn't that a little too close to cat piss?
I think that's on purpose. I think that's on purpose, Johnny. The rest of my life, that's fine because I like to be
chased. Because when you're chased, you're on the top of the hill and the top of the heap. Actually, just released just came out recently, wave of regular WWF figures. Where all the gimmick was the 100th set from Mattel. So the gimmick was they did a good number of legends with belt. All the figures came with a belt that had never been made before. And Steve Austin came with that TV title.
With the TV title.
Never get made as a,
That is one of
that
my
That
would have
been the last, I think he was the last holder of that particular style of title.
That was my interesting. That was one of my favorite, that TV belt is one of my favorite belt designs of all time. If I could have one belt to hang on the wall, that's the one I'd want.
One.
It looks so fucking
classic
cool.
Classic look.
Yeah. The man that he is. Yeah.
Red and silver really work together. I mean, I don't think it's ever been done since in a belt, but it really works together.
Oh, yeah, Dusty's got something to say. Crockett Promotions, the National Wrestling Alliance
got to understand that I've been in every kind of situation there is. Like he belt his own dressing room. Never have I ever. And I got there.
Yeah, I think he's in the Jefferson's apartment by the look of the wood behind him. How you
got it, the way you this is a shed. Business. But let me tell you something now. You can go. I went on down to the Home Depot. Throughout this land, no matter where yet, I'm gonna find you. If it's the last thing I ever do, I'm gonna hunt you down. Baby doll, I'm gonna hunt her down. If you think you're any kind of a man, after this television world's title now on your waist means anything at all to you. It means the world to me. Now you go find out what it's like to be the haunted, throughout your lifetime. If it's the last thing I do, throughout your lifetime, I'm gonna bring it back to where it belongs.
Wow.
You get ready for it now. You thought you had trouble before. Now then, you got to deal with me
Beepers, creepers.
For the rest of your life, Tully Blanchard. That's a fact.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah, baby.
Real. That's real, man. Yeah, yeah. Seeing those eyes bug out there, that's like, you know, when you talk about.
Check out the shot. The freeze frame shot is just Dusty with his eyes closed. That was awesome. That was good.
We didn't even get. They were teasing Raging Bull all night. We didn't even
I know.
Get them.
What happened?
It's not it. Well, that's your Raging Bull content. Is if you notice every single one of
the
these
bumpers.
Shows,
there's
okay. Every
you're watching one, the junk, the David Crockett Network.
Everyone, every
he
single
just shows up.
Travis, every single one of these shows. There's no little still shots to go to commercial promoting right. any other wrestler than Manny Fernandez.
You're right. You're right.
Sorry, not only now wow, we go look, way back
go.
Into the archives.
73
with a collar that could take out an eye.
Yeah,
look at that. He had to be drunk to choose that fucking outfit.
The great Gordon Solie.
Yeah, so much younger.
To the wind. Yeah.
What is he cooking? Is that a metal wok next to him?
I've got some rice steamer.
Iron Sheik tribute.
Awesome.
And this is, I think, the earliest footage you can find of the man. And he was wrestling as Ali Vasari at this time in Florida. And he's in the red trunks, of course. But yeah.
Wow. Super like, slim here.
Yeah.
Still, obviously, strength, right?
Yeah. And the date they gave on the video is 1973. I'm not sure if that's accurate, but it sounds about right.
He was good. This is when he was. I mean, you see pictures of the Sheik at this time, and you go, "That's a good-looking man."
Yeah,
he was a good-looking dude. Young man with
a great potential. And apparently, when he was young, he was like this, you know, straight shooter. You know, on the straight and narrow. Didn't drink, didn't smoke. Great athlete, and then wrestling
one day,
totally
tell me corrupted. More about this cocaine.
Yeah, he made up for lost time.
It's my medicine.
It's the worst drug. Youngsters and the worst drug there is, Sheiky. You don't want none of this, Sheiky. Just like the Dewey Cox story.
Oh, yes. I was just thinking of the new John Mulaney special. It's on Netflix. If you get a chance,
we started. We got about half an hour and we didn't finish it, but it's pretty funny. The name dropping.
It's hilarious. Fucking great because it's about nothing except his intervention.
Yeah.
And going to rehab. The entire hour is just that, and it's fucking great. And him calling out like, I remember people like, oh, Mulaney seems like kind of an asshole in these interviews, and him like quoting himself being a coked up asshole in interviews.
Yeah.
It's really fucking funny stuff. And the standing wrist lock by Ali Vasari.
Here's where Vasari will have Vasari, what can you tell us about his opponent, Kelly? Anything?
I do not know who he's wrestling.
So where is this?
Florida, probably Tampa, if I had to guess. I think that's where most of these shows are from.
So how drunk is Eddie Graham backstage right at this point?
I don't I guess he was quite. I don't know if he was drunk at shows.
But, okay.
I mean, Gordon Soley, of course, was. But.
Yeah. Well, tell you what. Yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry, Robert.
No, I was just saying that's the next. The only thing, I don't know if anybody read, you know, when Sheiky died, I read, I think it was the Slam Wrestling obituary, and it drove me nuts because they decided the one guy they would interview is noted honest as they come, Greg Gagne, who proceeded to relay the story of, you know, the first day Sheik showed up to be pro-trained, he said drop kicks weren't something you could really do in a fight, so of course, Vern knocked him out with a drop kick, according to that.
Of course he did.
My dad.
Then he threw a silver dollar across the fucking river, right?
Yes, yeah. Pal. What do you mean, rocking chairs? Kabow! Catches Vasari, glancing bro
across the chest, and... But yeah, he was trained in Minnesota at the Gagne camp. I think it's the same year as Flair, right, Robert?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so 72, that class. And, of course, he would have started
the
there.
Drop kick. See? Yeah, but he looked, I learned a lesson from him.
Yeah.
Now I use drop kick.
Ooh, that was nice. That was
beautiful.
Excellent.
That's
that was
it.
So sweet.
That was great.
That was straight out of, like, some Japanese 80s shoot promotion.
Sure. Wow. I want to just... take a moment now to say that we certainly hope that my rice is done.
So it looks like he wasn't there too long. Maybe
it's his little robot friend.
Yeah, I was gonna say that too.
What's next, Gordon? What match are we talking about next, Gordon?
Another drink, Gordon?
More whiskey, Gordon?
My director, Jerry. Vodka, I believe, was Gordon's.
Please, Gordon. Well, sorry, Gordon. Vodka?
Well, I think you know the answer to that, Flaglorn.
Flaglorn?
I don't know. He's just extra drunk, so it sounds.
That's just he's slurring something. We just don't know what.
Okay, now we're a few years later. 1977, I believe.
This was something that you had recommended, right, Robert?
Well, this was the earliest footage I could find of him being called the Iron Sheik.
Mm-hmm. I think it's, I think this was the first time in the AWA. I would like
to ask you, the sunglasses make this.
Oh, should be listened to. It is.
The sunglasses make him look like a guy who like in OPEC, you know,
right, right.
who were heels at the time. The mustache, the look.
Right. Yeah, that was Abdul Weasel in Stampede Wrestling. 100% right. Look like.
I mean, like the Iron Sheik is the reason why we had to wait in line for gas.
Well, he's billed as being from Lebanon here.
Oh, okay.
Interesting. Yeah. I watched some
that's a Iron Sheik
promos with my Iranian students last semester. And some of them were laughing through it because he goes from Persian to Arabic and back and forth.
I was about to say that mustache of his is a fine looking mustache. Only a certain kind of man can pull off a mustache.
Yeah. No doubt.
Hey, check this out. Yeah, look getting, at that
there they are.
Persian clubs. We'll no, be seeing them trademark. Plenty of time.
Yeah, I can do the mustache. The I can't do this.
Yeah.
This is my favorite Iron Sheik because he does indeed.
It comes with it. I love it. That's so cool, man.
Wow, that's like the one exact one. To prepare him for
that action, that all important action in the ring. Oh, dear. Every time.
Yeah, the mustache is because he would change it later. It'd become right, more curly.
I might go curly. You never know.
Yeah. I'm sure he's
gonna next time I come to Vancouver, I'll have a curly hipster mustache. I'll also be riding a bicycle with one big wheel.
Well, that was great. And now we're on to Mid-Atlantic in 1980. 240
pounds. Here is Tony
Tossi.
Yeah. So now, yes, we get the classic mustache that we just
and mentioned. Gene Anderson was his manager, right?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. I don't know much about this run for Sheik at all.
He had a long Jim Brunzel, I remember. Over.
Okay, this was right after he had his run in New York as Great Hussein Arab.
Mm-hmm. And that with that one match against Backlund, we watched for one of the first Titans. That was just
and also the hidden gem against Dominic DiNucci.
Yeah, like the ECW.
Yeah,
fucking match.
That one's never on YouTube. It's impossible to find that one.
Really, I'd love to see it. Sounds incredible. Mm-hmm.
It's fucking incredible, dude.
Yeah, you may have saw it, Trev, because you had the discs.
Oh yeah. Maybe
do you still have them? I don't know. They've been
either with me or with Sean. Yeah.
Sean has some of them. Yeah. I think all you
of
still have some.
All of my all of my DVDs are in a tub in the crawl space. Mm-hmm. So I have them, but I don't have a DVD player. So.
Yeah. I don't know which ones I have. I have most of them, but yeah, some of them are out there.
Who's he against here? Looks like S.A. Morales.
Tony Torrey.
Tim Tossi. Was it? Tim Tossi? Yeah. Tossi?
Todd
I think Turley? Coddle said Tossi.
Todd Turley.
La Bamba has a Criterion collection coming out, they just announced. I'm interested. Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah. When I was a kid, I loved that movie. And
man, we listened to that. That was like a family. Wait,
so Gene Anderson is vacation. Popeye Doyle. Is that what?
Totally.
Yeah.
Most importantly, we see the boots. The boots are what's
right. It's pretty cool seeing.
When I was a kid, the first time I saw those boots, I was like, I liked them. I was like, even against Slaughter, I was young enough to want to see Slaughter kick his ass, but I fucking loved the boots. I liked the Iron Sheik. I thought he was a cool bad guy.
Yeah, they are
and
cool.
And you could load them up. It was fucking great.
We got to share your Halloween costume when we post this.
Oh, yeah. God, I don't know where that is. He's going to pick him up for another slam. I did a really good, I pulled off a really good Iron Sheik.
Oh, yeah. I've seen that picture.
Well, it's funny because WWE on their website, they offered like two Halloween costumes. For adults, one had fake muscles, so did the Sheik one, but the Sheik one had foam pointy boots and foam the Persian rug pants, which were my favorite look of the Iron Sheik, and the headdress and everything else. I was like, well, I could just fucking go buy fake gold medals and make my own t-shirt that says Iran on it and curl my mustache. I shaved my whole beard off and curled my mustache up just for that costume. And then I did it 2 years later because I was working and it was at the strip club, and I just redid the costume. And I'm had to talk to some customer who was getting mad at me because I had a shirt that said Iran on it. I was like getting in my fucking face, and I was trying to say, I'm the Iron Sheik, I'm the wrestler. And he was just like not having it, and he wanted to kick my ass. It always works out well for when you're the customer at the strip club wanting to get into it with staff at the strip club.
Yeah.
It didn't work out.
Yeah, yeah. Jesus Christ.
I felt so like, come on. I was really like, come on, you're not, you must know who the Iron Sheik is. Everyone knows who the Iron Sheik is.
Or I thought you were from Iron Chef.
Well, I mean, when he died, man, Twitter and social media blew up of people who were not connected with the rest of Patton Oswalt was like, posted a picture of Sheik, like, goodbye Sheik, you know.
Yeah, one of the more recognizable wrestlers for a mainstream audience, for sure.
I mean, it sounds like the people running his Twitter account were kind of exploitative.
Oh, they were totally exploitative.
And now they're gonna kind of shift to, I think they run Virgil's as well. Oh, I think that's gonna be their new project.
I don't know if they're the same guys, but you want exploitative. That Iron Sheik documentary, Sheik. It's rough, and it feels at times like the filmmakers are enabling him, let's just say.
Yeah. Is it as bad as the Teddy Hart doc? Or not quite that?
No, no, it's a good doc. It's a good doc, and it gets to the bottom of what, you know, his daughter was murdered, and that's when he truly spiraled, and, you know, it gets bottom. But it's just like, drive me to my drug dealer. You got it, Sheik, and let's keep the cameras on. You know, that kind of shit.
Denise says that Eric guy was the worst. Must be from the...
They would book him on, like, Opie and Anthony and Stern, hoping that he'd piss his pants and shit, which he did.
Right.
Pissed his pants on Opie and Anthony.
Oh. Yeah, none of that whole Sheik as a drunk, drugged out guy appeared to me at all.
Best and worst of the American dream in one person.
Yeah, good point.
It's really going after this guy's face.
I like
tonight.
This. Yeah.
Looks like the guy who plays, Rocky Johnson on Young Rock.
Okay. God, look at Gene Anderson. I just can't get over him.
I know.
I know.
Cool. I want to know more about Gene as a manager.
Yeah. It looks
didn't
like he's
last too long, I don't think.
Yeah. That is correct. He looks like he does a lot of heavy breathing into telephones.
Ooh. David Crockett on commentary here.
He's such a scumbag. Look at him. He looks totally. Like...
Has Sheila started dancing yet?
That's somebody would always ask you, Johnny. Has Sheila gone up yet?
Believe it or not,
no, Ronald. No, Ronald. He's not here yet. She's not here yet.
I'll go take my seat.
I had one or two where they're like, oh, is so-and-so working tonight?
Oh, yeah.
No, she's not, but we had one guy who would come in and pay older guy, psychiatrist, who would come in and pay like $200 just not for dances, just to have the time of this one particular dancer who was a little older and sit in the corner, and he'd spend all this money and was not creepy and would leave. It was just like, I talk to nuts all day and I just need to sit here and talk to a hot chick who I can talk to. I'll pay $200. This is therapy. Beautiful. There he is. He loaded up that boot.
And that man was Mark Zuckerberg.
Yep.
Hey, boss. Good to see you, buddy. One of my favorite. One of the mods on this channel. But started off, he's one of the guys who always watches me stream. That's right.
Ooh,
you want to rephrase that?
Nasty suplex.
How many guys like to watch you stream? How many guys like to watch you stream, Travis? You could really get. Hey, Travis, we could cross our streams. We could cross our streams. We could get a lot more viewers.
Crisscross crash.
When he really got kicked hard in the chest by that boot from the Sheik.
No camel clutch yet.
No. Not yet. Nope.
He didn't have that as the same Arab either, if I remember correctly.
No.
Eric Sims was Iron Sheik's creep manager, Denise says, yeah.
Eric Sims, okay. They said Gene Anderson.
No, I mean, and back, going back to your documentary talking about.
Okay.
Oh, I thought Johnny was choking.
Ooh, look at this guy. Just tuck that chin in time, man. Get that leg, get that arm in.
Elbow is super stiff, too.
Yeah.
No, Kelly, that would Kelly, that would have been funny if that would have been a joke. That was just me going, huh? Who's this? Is this Dirty Dutch? No.
I think that was Mulligan.
It's like they shot this Mulligan? Underwater.
Yeah, I know the footage quality may not be the greatest for this, but it's another Persian Clubs challenge bit. Yeah, it's Mulligan.
Is that Johnny Weaver? Who's with
him? Yeah, this is Weaver. This Caroline is again Mid-Atlantic again. Caudill and Weaver, I guess.
The worst looking footage we've seen on this.
there's
80s, early 80s.
Yeah.
There's as much
generation dub tape.
Yeah. There's as much Vaseline on that lens as there is for that 80 for Brady movie that came out with
it's Gloria Swanson. I'm ready for my close up.
Ready from a close up, Mr. DeVitt. In the mill. But for the American public,
I am going to try to do those clubs. Cool. So he's going to give it a shot. Where is this?
Carolina's Crockett.
Okay.
Was it WRAL Studios, I want to say? Oh, no.
It's an AMC.
Belligerent friend. Sign of things to come. I'll turn this up a bit.
I got $1,000 to give you, Mulligan. He's already got the gun.
And there's Gene Anderson, our new favorite guy. Man, yeah, I want to dig into this dude. Why don't you give me just one little demonstration
there how you do these things? You're going to show him how. Well, you know he's half of the legendary Andersons with Oli.
Is that all really?
Yeah, the Minnesota Wrecking Crew. The original
Minnesota Wrecking Crew.
Okay. But I've never seen him as a manager.
Me neither.
Yeah, I don't think he, outside of the Carolinas at this period, I don't think he worked anywhere else.
Feels like a really nice fit.
Dude, his hair is fucking just terrible. It's great. Look at one, the comb over, but he's bald.
Sadly, that's my dad's hair now. That's the bald comb over.
Real life Homer Simpson.
I did that for a Halloween costume one year in my in my 20s, where I grew out my hair. I shaved the toilet bowl in and left it all like a Larry Fine a little bit. And then I got fake hair and I made three big comb overs and worked it into my real hair, you know, with hairspray and gel. And a pencil thin mustache. I got a suit that probably Gene Anderson would be wearing. I looked like it was Mr. Furley's leftovers, right? With chains, a skin tight fucking shirt. I walk into our bar that we always went to for Halloween, and revulsion of people as people, because we're just arriving. The dinner crowd was just leaving, and the bartender who I'd known for years, I sit down. He looks at me like, "Who the fuck is this creep?" Then he looks again. He goes, "Because my nickname was Homer there." And he goes, "Homer?" I'm like, "Yeah, Rob, how you doing?" He's like, "Jesus Christ, dude, what did you do to yourself?"
Hilarious.
I won the Lighthouse Tavern worst costume contest. It was a trophy of a
oh, nice. Oh, yeah. Ooh. Fuck yeah.
Oh, that hurts.
That's a cute baby.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that really is. Oh, those are nasty whips.
Could actually do that.
Yeah.
Long. Probably not. That's why they had to do it so quickly. Whip.
That's fantastic. Listen to the children screaming. Women screaming.
Yeah, that's why I picked this, even with the footage being crappy, is I knew it was a good beat down.
Yeah.
Some of that gay cowboy porn you were talking about, you get a little Asian, get a little Middle Eastern
cowboys and Persians. That's a very specific subset of gay porn.
I'm so rock hard right now. Gene Anderson is. Gene Anderson's about to blast. He's about to blast in his pants.
He's like, what's his name? What's that? Philip Seymour Hoffman in Happiness.
All right, as I was saying,
continues the promo. No big deal.
Okay, should we try that again?
They branded me. Look at my asshole. Look what it did to my beautiful asshole.
Where's the hard cam, Mike?
If I was allowed to show you my asshole, you'd see what happened.
Gotta sell the welts.
See, because they're trying to show the back.
Trying to sell the
finally
welts.
Makes sense.
No, I think that's David Crockett.
Yeah, it is.
That is a young David Crockett.
Mm-hmm.
You're right.
Much darker hair than I've ever seen.
Because they were the commentary team on the previous match. Mulligan was a top babyface in the territory at this time.
Yeah, it's funny. Like I'm not interested in anything Conrad related at this point. But on one of the things he has on the pay service they do is him and David Crockett just going through the booking books and all the books of Crockett of the time period we started with. And I mean, and he's like apparently nice but brutally honest. I was like, is there a way I could just get that? I want to watch that, but I don't want to pay for everything else. Hello, nurse.
Telling me we're not supposed to cheer for.
Now we're in Georgia with another different manager. Tommy Wildfire Rich.
Prince Valiant refereeing.
And a Nazi, right?
Hogan's Heroes.
That's Sergeant Schultz's SS. That's Sergeant Schultz's SS.
I hear nothing.
No, I think
I
it's Homer Odell, I believe, is his name.
That's his
Homer Odell, yeah.
Yeah, he was a longtime Southern heel manager.
He's got the pants of a Mountie. It's interesting. He's mixed them all up.
Sleek or Sheik is still so thin.
I
thought he's wearing his ECW pants. It looks like they'd be something he'd wear if he ever went there.
Would be these pants.
Yeah.
No, these aren't the ones I love, but they're close.
Close.
It's close to...
They almost look like kind of jorts. You know, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I mean, he'd go Persian rug pants. The Persian rug, exactly. The Persian
hustle,
rug
loyalty, pants. Respect.
His Persian rug pants. He wore them in WWF every now and then.
And it was the LGN figurehead Persian rug.
Right,
pants.
Right.
I loved those. That was the Halloween costume. Was the Persian rug pants.
Yeah.
Now, if I could have gotten a Homer Odell outfit, I think that really would have gotten over at the fucking bar.
says depends on what bar you go to.
So he's a Nazi highway patrolman?
Or like those are the Mounties always have that. Canadian police tend to have a yellow stripe.
Yeah, but he's got a motorcycle helmet on.
I know, it's really bizarre.
Okay, so...
That's my seat. I'll show you. Sorry, so I made the mistake. Honest mistake.
Larry Zbysko just came took Homer Odell's.
Larry Zbysko just arrived after being the stunt double for Jack Tripper.
or from the setup. Just finished doing a painting for Bob Ross, filling it. Looks like something Bob Ross would wear.
I always thought Roddy Piper circa 84-85 resembled John Ritter.
John Ritter, yeah, sure.
Fire Rich, and apparently that's exactly what he's doing. Obviously trying to upset him if he can psychologically by being on hand.
Tommy Rich with his cousin Oliver from the Brady Bunch hair. He was a sex symbol because you know the magazines told me so.
Said so, yes.
Travis,
World Championship
Wrestling is going. He had horse faced Kerry Von Erich, fucking Ricky Morton, Tommy Rich.
Can't all be Ricky Steamboat.
Yeah, I know. And Ricky Steamboat and Rick Martel would be there sticking out like a sore thumb. Hulk Hogan was one of their sexy guys, too.
Hilarious.
Let me tell you something, brother. I got a cock like a goddamn thermos.
I'm so bloated.
That's interesting.
Quote on the front. That's the quote on the front of the aftermake. I'm so bloated right now.
Hot as sex symbols.
Interesting mix of talent. You got Tommy Rich, Iron Sheik, Larry Zbyszko at ringside, and Ric Flair is on commentary.
Wow.
Larry Z kicks ass.
And the bass player from Kansas is the referee.
This is like he's dressed like McLovin. That's the exact same outfit McLovin wears when he's trying to look older in Superbad. Give me the Zbyszko, McLovin said.
Insane. For the what year is this again?
83.
Larry Zbyszko is fucking looking good. That is the height of fashion.
83? I don't know.
Oh, how total.
He looks a little David Cassidy. Yeah, he looks a little David Cassidy.
Let me tell you, if I saw I would have dressed like that in 83 as well.
But 1983, if you look at the fashions, it was still the 70s, basically.
Yeah, that, exactly.
84 is the 84. Real beginning of the 80s.
Okay, 84 is when I discovered goddamn a merry-go-round. And started wearing fucking parachute pants and ridiculous bullshit.
It's true. Like there's a clear difference. Like 83 is like the last year of the 70s.
He did indeed, and near fall. I wore some embarrassing clothes. Is what I'm saying.
This must be, if not close to the last place he worked before he went to the WWF.
Probably. He's eventually part of the original Legion of Doom, which was a stable and not just the tag team that had like 10 different guys in it. But that's when Paul Ellering was his manager. So that, I guess, is after this.
Oh, hey, baby. Just leaning back here. You know, getting ready to head out to the next John Denver special. I'm a guest star.
Jack.
I'm Jack Tripper. Get it? I tripped you, Tommy.
Catches him once again. Look at those
ladies. It's all a misunderstanding.
Haven't you seen the show? Oh!
Awesome. Oh, and Flair, too.
Now Flair.
Awesome.
Flair and Zbyszko rarely
This all
ever...
looks like a fight in the Regal Beagle, for sure.
Yeah, dumb, totally.
Nice. Nice. Gets one in. The fuck was that, man?
Dude, that's
like I owed you that. That's a receipt for. Yeah, I get one of those every time I come in and you're in the same room, because you are not the Nature Boy.
That's a lot of talent.
Oh, no. Oh yeah, I'm thinking of the other guy. Sorry, I got mixed up. I'm thinking of Buddy Landell for a second. Let's review the
situation. They had a similar background or after hours affairs.
Gordon Sully's gonna show up in the park wearing that fucking flower to give a signal to meet another guy in the men's room. I know that. I know the flower. It's the flower, the bandana, the flower. I learned that in an episode of Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. I'm just saying. You're supposed to be the world heavyweight champion. You know, that's what it's all about. You're supposed to be the man. You say you're the one. You're a gentleman. You go by the rules. Well, you just showed everybody what kind of damn man you are. See, now this was on TBS, right? So that's the Magnum Dark Side sort of went into this too, is because when Jim Crockett got TBS, that's why it just came down to Vince and Crockett, because everyone had TBS if you had cable. That was like, so. And you had great wrestling on it. You know, people were watching it. That's why 85, 86, in 87, dude, it's two major promotions.
Well, early 80s, Georgia on TBS was the highest rated cable show on TV of anything. Right. Not just wrestling, just cable. Hugely popular.
And just only see
all the master tapes get wrecked in his garage.
Yeah.
Like deliberately, he said, it was out of spite. I didn't want anyone to have it, so I let him get ruined.
Who was that, Robert?
Holy.
Ole sounds Anderson. Like something Ole would do.
Another, how many? We could do like a full show just on the Iranian
just club. The clubs.
Yeah. This one's, and we were talking about Paul Ellering. This is Paul Ellering.
Oh, there's Ellering.
Wow.
Yeah, that's Bleach the wrestler. Blonde Ellering. This is mid-side.
Look at the old guy in the front and his wife.
Yeah. He's going to drop one of those and kill Mildred.
It'd be the, what was it called? The Boys Club.
Yeah.
Or whatever in
Shreveport,
Louisiana.
Yeah, you're the Boys Club.
I think Mid-South is the only place Akbar would have managed it.
Precious Paul did 50, yeah.
Right? Precious Paul.
It's fucking, dude, people don't realize just how fucking jacked Paul Ellering was.
Yeah, and he was a total Superstar Graham ripoff, too.
Yeah.
Down to the tie-dye trunks.
How long of a wrestling career did he have, and why did
it? Pretty long.
And?
I don't know if it was too long, but... I don't know if he was hurt. I think it was an injury that caused him to stop wrestling.
Yeah, and that Legion of Doom thing took off because he was
Yeah,
he wasn't just a kayfabe manager for those mm-hmm. guys. He literally was the manager.
Mm-hmm.
I just received some upsetting video that, all the boom shows take place at a Legion. And due to recent events, the portrait of the king and queen have been replaced.
Oh,
but the finally. New, and now they're pictures, right? Oh, so it's not as cool. Oh, right?
So you have to have.
Camilla so they're pictures, pictures of Camilla.
Charles and Camilla are up in the fucking. Yeah, how gross is that?
That's pretty bad because Charles does not look very good right now.
Nope.
Mumray, we're off to the
every
brim,
time
sir.
I'm at the grocery store, there's that whatever it is, People magazine with him on the cover, and he just looks horrible.
When he has all that stuff on, I got too much fucking shit on me.
With
there's
all
too
the
much fucking
regalia,
shit on me.
And he looks like an old woman.
Yeah, dude, he looks.
We knew it was coming. We had a feeling it was coming, but our little section of the Legion is kind of separate, so we thought. Oh wow!
Oh hey, this is okay. Okay, what the fuck are you watching? This
talk about being rock hard. That grandpa, dude, that cowboy in the front.
That cowboy. Oh dude, that old man cowboy hat. He's slowly jerking off. Slowly.
This is the best we've ever seen anyone do outside of Iron Sheik with these. Even though he's just doing this. 35, 36, 37. They said the previous guy got up to 55. I think.
I don't know, but Rob Reiner's keeping count of how many in the corner there.
51. There.
Oh. 51. There you go.
I think he got to 52. That was pretty rad, man. It's good that we got to see somebody.
Jesus, watch.
Yeah, I guess Blackjack Mulligan was like, fuck this, I'm not.
Pearl Harbor. Spinal tap. No knobs go to 11. This is crazy.
Stand by me, make me cry, but this shit.
I once had leech on my own penis. By choice.
It was part of old school Iranian wrestling style.
Made me humble.
Put it up your ass, Reiner.
Oh, God.
Right over your fart box.
Fart box. We're bringing back the fart box.
Yeah. It was such a hit. Oh, is this the match I recommended?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. This was getting passed around. I'd never seen it. And I checked out like a couple seconds of it. And I was like, oh, we got to watch this.
Cool. Yeah, this is probably the most. Well known the Iron Sheik would ever be, like on a
yeah,
in terms of like active wrestler,
for sure. No,
Denise says, Ellering was a wrestler from the mid 70s to 82 due to injury.
Yeah,
thanks, pal.
Yeah, I mean, 84 he had the title, lost to Hogan. Then had the feud with Sergeant Slaughter, legendary.
Right, but this is just before it takes off, right? This is just before it takes off nationwide.
Right.
So more people are gonna remember him from lesser stuff.
Yeah, rock and wrestling and stuff, right? Is that why? Is that what I was gonna say, Robert? Is that why the Iron Sheik was your first favorite wrestler?
Yeah, I'd seen the first thing I ever saw wrestling was Tito Santana wearing sunglasses in a hospital bed, vowing revenge against Greg Valentine. My dad explaining to me what wrestling was. I said, "Dad, why is he wearing sunglasses in a hospital?"
I'm sorry, hold on. JYD is wearing a camouflage hat and it is badass. Sorry.
Don't drop it. Look at people trying to grab it.
You know what? I'll salute that flag for this. Okay? This makes me feel patriotic.
Yeah.
I haven't felt patriotic in years. Look at JYD in all camo. Fuck yeah, baby. They're going to beat some motherfucking communists. He hit the kid in the flyer shirt.
Yeah.
Look at this.
That was just like what Shawn Michaels would do with the Canadian flag many years later.
Yeah, see, I believe Slaughter when he kisses and hugs a flag. It doesn't like when Trump was like, I'm going to molest this flag. It likes it. It likes it when I molest the flag. People seem to like it.
Yeah, so the first thing I watched regularly when I was five was the cartoon on Saturday mornings.
Okay, there you go. There you go.
Before I started watching wrestling. And Sheik and Volkov were basically played in the cartoon as like the comedy villains. Piper was like the villain, and they were the stumbling idiots. And I was a huge fan of like Beast Man and Trapjaw, right. He-Man, the exact same characterization. Like,
perfect. Yeah.
So Sheik was actually my favorite wrestler way before I started watching wrestling by about a year.
That's adorable.
Here
man.
We go. All right, Chains. We already got fucking Chains. This is already my favorite thing I've seen in forever.
He's got a.
Look at this.
Elmer Fudd.
Texas Tornado rules.
He's the original GI bro.
Look at all the trash in that ring.
Uh-huh, because Philadelphia is full of fucking animals.
Yeah. Oh, speaking of which.
Yeah.
She can hold up just
full lager. Oh, man, raining beer. It's raining beer. Philadelphia, it's raining beer. This is great. All right,
time to get a sample. Bend over, Sheik. His fucking swizzle stick or whatever the fuck Marella. It's called.
Riding crop.
Yeah, it's got a military fucking
swagger stick.
Swagger awesome. Stick.
That's it. Swagger stick. Thanks, Robert. You know, and as far as logos in the fucking ring go, I like that Spectrum logo. I think that looks.
Mm-hmm. That's sweet.
Man. I can't believe how much garbage is getting thrown at him. And nobody's kicking. Great. Morella's not doing his job. Vince was encouraging him. Let the garbage stay.
Well, there's our buddy Cal Rudman.
Right. Well, no, it didn't say Cal was on call.
No, he's not on commentary. He's at ringside.
Oh, he's at ringside. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
He was still
there's the beef t-shirt. So
where's the beef shirt?
Here. See, there he is right there.
That's when the 80s truly arrived.
There he is. This is goddamn awesome. Jesus. I was the one who said, keep the garbage in the ring. It looks great.
This is awesome.
I think I told you guys, I found a 85 WF magazine recently at a like used bookstore or something. And one of the main features, I'll scan it if I can. I don't want to wreck it and upload it for you guys, was an interview with Cal Rudman.
Nice.
And he apparently
Iran sucks.
Cindy Lauper thing, according to the magazine.
What's that?
He apparently was the one who sent up the Cindy Lauper deal.
Oh yeah, he did. He did.
He's really, you could make an argument, Cal Rudman's one of the big catalysts of rock and wrestling and WrestleMania happening.
He was. And he, as he told us in part of the interview, part of it I did that didn't get recorded. And my divorce, that. Biggest disappointments of my life. He's taking a piss on him. Gonna piss on you,
maggot.
I heard you like that, Sheiky.
The crowd is so in love with it. Look at those drunk Wall Street guys coked out of their minds in the front row.
Yeah, I mean, that's crazy, even by Philly standards.
Yeah.
The Philadelphia, I don't know what the Philadelphia
is. Look at that guy, old guy having the time of his life, that usher.
Yeah.
Oh man, not since my honeymoon.
Jesus Christ, now I'm rock hard. Mickey Dolenz having a good time there in the corner.
Young Kurt Russell. This is incredible.
There probably looked like a young John Hedgepeth in that crowd there. Yeah. He saw the kid with the glasses going, this is fucking great. It looked kind of awkward.
Is this a little before you started going?
Look at this crowd.
Oh, yeah. This is before I was going, dude. Slaughter was long gone by the time we started going to live. I'm sorry. Hold on. He was long gone from WWF. I saw Slaughter a bunch at Pro Wrestling USA shows at the Meadowlands. Cage match with Kamala that was going on at the same time as there was some sort of fucking hostage crisis going on that lasted like 12 days. I can't remember where. And Slaughter, after beating up Kamala, leads the crowd in the Pledge of Allegiance.
That number 81?
For our brave hostages.
Yeah, who was 81?
I don't know. For the Niners?
It's not an Eagles jersey. Yeah, I know. Yeah. It's like you should be... beat up and have the jersey destroyed
it's
by this
probably
point.
A local, it's probably a local high school
football team, man.
There's a lot it's of flags like in that crowd.
Like, there's so much interesting stuff happening in the ring, but I'm so drawn to this crowd, man.
Because Philly's the best fucking crowd. Yeah. Man, I'm telling you.
But this is next level.
Mm-hmm.
Even from the Philly shows we've seen.
Well, Slaughter Sheik was the hottest fucking angle.
Which reminds me, I got it. Yeah.
And they also they didn't do singles matches with them in Philly for whatever reason.
Put that on the Patreon.
So this was kind of their boot camp match.
My balls.
Oh. And this is when JYD had just come in. And he was super fucking over. You look at him. He looks like a brick shit house. He's great.
Right, right. I was wondering how many fuck the garbage. How many times did these two tag together?
This might be it for all.
That's what I'm wondering. No, yeah, yeah.
Not much because Slaughter was on his way out.
This is awesome. This is absolutely a hidden gem.
Unless there's more,
and
this
has a reputation. Look at this.
They
crowd.
Had a match the previous month. I've seen that, and this is the rematch. But yeah, I've never seen this before.
Holy shit. Oh, I love that spot from Sarge. Yeah. Graze that steel post.
Cal Rudman is talking to this fucking crowd, telling him to fucking stop throwing shit.
Yeah. You see him there? Look at him.
There's a guy, look, there's a military fella and a guy in a weird hat.
Looks like the world's toughest caddy.
Yeah.
Absolutely crazy. The garbage. I've never seen so much. It's like NWO times 10, but it's for the whole match.
WrestleMania 3. You see how much garbage Andre gets?
Right, right, right. That's all, like more on the way out, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's the way I remember it, yeah.
I know I've seen other Philadelphia Spectrum matches like this. I know there was a legendary one.
The Mole Man observes.
There's a legendary one I've heard about where Gorilla Monsoon actually gets in the ring on the microphone, tells people they keep throwing shit.
Yeah.
They're going to stop the show and people threw more shit.
I know. Is that the worst thing you can do?
And there's the one where Nikolai Volkoff was singing the anthem and he gets hit in the head with an apple and he doesn't miss a beat and just keeps singing.
Yeah. I may have mentioned this in previous things, but our buddy Max has told us a story about how he went to a monster truck show in Vancouver where, like, there were people just, like, running out on the...
I'm rock hard now.
But, it, like, they had to keep warning people, and they were throwing shit. Like, the crowd was awful, but...
This is a human caterpillar.
What the fuck are you watching? Human centipede, yeah.
Yeah. Centipede, right.
But I guess the guy who drove Gravedigger got on the microphone and said, this is the worst place in North America. And it was like, boo! Just massive boos. The dog is in bad trouble.
Look out!
Crazy.
That's it, I bet. Nope.
Iran and Russia suck.
As a little kid, right. Okay, I gotta tell you, as a kid, I never bought Volkoff and Sheik because I'm such a nerd. I was like, fucking Iran and Russia had like a war just like a couple of years ago. They're not fucking allies. It's fucking stupid.
I wouldn't have known any of that. I was, I just knew like, okay,
Afghanistan
we're supposed to
know. And Russia.
Yeah, Afghanistan.
I don't know. Russia and Iran.
During World War II.
Yeah, Russia. No, during the
Iranian, World War II.
No, during the Iranian hostage crisis, there was a brief bunch of skirmishes between Russia and Iran. And I remember because I was in the fourth grade and I asked the teacher, I was like, why don't we just ask the Russians to go in and get the fucking hostages? And she had to explain to me, like, more politics. Like, but this way we could have peace, right?
And you're like, no. I have a couple thumb wrestlers. I'll show you.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
They came together. They came together in a package, Mrs. Anderson.
And if you put your thumbs up their asses and put your hands together, we can all come together.
Very simple. Very basic.
And that was how Johnny got expelled from the fourth.
I just saved you a week's of work, lady.
So when are we going to get to the whole thumb asshole thing? Because Mrs. Saeta was hot, dude. Just saying.
Thumb asshole. Covered in sawdust or maggots.
Maggots. Jesus Christ. Who left a dead raccoon under the ring?
That was the Sarge stipulation. We're going to surround the ring with maggots because of you maggots. And it really bit JYD in the back, literally.
Well, they don't bite; they just squish. I know. It's even grosser, right?
Gosh, it's like at least everything is taken.
I deal with them on the regular.
Yeah, I just hate that trip to the compost, man.
Nice. It's just God's miracle, Travis.
Yes, of course it is. Man is on his feet. The dog still trying to shake the maggots off his back.
And this
Tom for the clutch. Nice.
You know, is it any wonder this is where ECW started? Guy, right. Come on. Look at this.
Amazing.
I don't think I've ever seen Slaughter beat Sheik with this.
Look at this. There's people fucking wanting to storm the fucking ring over
here. Yeah.
There.
This is right. The peak of patriotism, too, I guess. Eh?
Mm-hmm. Nice Sheik. He's done.
Nope.
Oh.
I don't. Yeah, Volkov's got a chair. So that's.
Yeah.
But this is no DQ, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. You think?
Yeah.
Travis,
I know. It's
been Texas
a mess. Like, it's just so many. Yeah. Oh, there we go. But I mean, like, nobody had used a weapon.
That would be an AEW right. thing right. to have a match like this, then suddenly there's rules. Yeah.
Okay. There we go. Oh,
that's it.
Fantastic.
Nice.
That was great. Awesome. One of the best matches we've seen on this.
Cal
just because of this crowd. Look at that kid. Larry Bird. Chubby Larry Bird. Eat Larry Bird. That's fucking awesome, man. That was so good. David from Sesame Street. Oh.
Jimmy Jackson.
The one last Persian club challenge of the
nice.
Night.
I like that we've sprinkled them throughout the trademark. Yeah.
And great this choice. Is going back in time a little bit to December 83. This is a very significant, historically significant segment coming up for those who know their history.
I was going to go have a dart, but now I need to wait.
Yeah, you should probably watch this one if you haven't seen it before.
My family is out of town on a camping trip, and I almost brought the computer and the gear up into the garage, old school Titan style, so I could fucking chain smoke with the door open and you guys could hear traffic, but I decided against it.
That would have been tough.
Every now and then.
Kind of historic because at least I had hoped. I mean, when I was, you know, Harvey used to joke the Titans' number one fan. This is what I hoped would be the start of the original last episode of Titans of Wrestling if it had gone as long as I hoped it would, which is
it would have probably
that was
been,
the plan, right?
You
know, yeah,
yeah, it was going to end with Sheik beating Backlund. So yeah, right. this would have been on the last episode. You're right, probably.
I would have also lobbied for we also watch Hogan Backlund, and I mean Hogan Sheik, and then be done. If we had gone that long, just because you gotta fucking, I mean, that.
Yeah, we probably would.
You can't end on the towel. We hear the Titans of Wrestling are thrown in the towel, just like Arnold Skolin. Goodbye. Mario's not impressed over here.
Yeah. What are these are different.
What are these? Mario's just like, these look like a giant tampons. What the fuck?
Oh, boy.
Where's the old ones? Where's those cool wooden ones?
This is all the Flyers hockey tape. They need this, you know.
Classy.
Pelle Lindberg is starting in net tonight.
These look like, okay, remember Giganta from Super Friends? Those are her tampons.
Saturday Night Fever Bob, same suit he had in 1979.
Some serious collars tonight.
Of course I know this, yeah.
What year is this?
83.
83? This is what led this
84 definitely hadn't arrived. Yeah.
This is what leads to the title change.
This is what leads to the 80s arriving.
Well,
pretty much.
Does, in a way.
Yeah.
In wrestling it does.
Yeah. Pretty funny.
He just came from Studio 54. Yeah, he's cranked on coke.
Last holdout.
He was cock blocked by both Chrissy and Janet.
Shake, shake, shake. Yeah. Shake, shake, shake your booty.
Shake your back, Lind. Shake your back, Lind.
Mr. Furley blew him in the men's room, though, so he's okay, but he would have rather had Janet.
He even lost a lot of mass at this point back from his peak.
Lana. Even Lana said no.
Now watch this carefully. This is also a classic wrestle crap botch moment too coming up.
If Mr. Backlund is the falter here, certainly don't fault Bob Backlund. Mr. Backlund, I would suspect is trying.
Why are they? First time. They look ridiculous.
Yeah,
those old wooden ones looked fucking.
Like everybody else came to it with so much confidence.
Now you know what? Because these are gimmicked ones. Those hit the real ones and the gimmicked ones, right?
But I mean, Backlund could have handled the real ones. He was super strong.
Fucking Ayatollah Blassie. That's my favorite fucking thing.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna put this on my head now. I'm the Ayatollah Blassie.
It's cool with your people, right?
There we go. Well, I hadn't gone full vegetarian, I might not have lost the title.
Now it looks kind of Chippendale too. The way he shakes his hippie
shake it
shirt.
Out, baby. Check it out.
Now watch all this.
Why is he holding on to it? Like he loves
it. Because it looks so light now. Yeah, just bouncing around.
Yeah, because it's supposed to hurt injure him, right? Because he goes into the title match.
That's just it. He goes in hurt because of the club fucking up his neck.
But the way they did it. Like the clubs immediately fell like to the to the side. Yeah,
like
so
paper
he had
mache.
To physically pick them up and like rub them on his neck.
Right. Hilarious. Nowhere to be
found. Yeah. That's not quite as bad as the belt being destroyed by crying, but it's up there.
I don't know if Bob mentions this. Being looking like shit in his biography.
I think he does,
Okay, but I know he certainly mentions the belt tearing and the crying, being just like, oh god, it sucked so bad.
Yeah.
If you haven't read that Backlund biography, guys, I highly recommend
it's a great
it.
Book.
It's fucking, yeah, really it's good. One of the best of the wrestler bios.
Okay, whoever printed it. It made a few editing mistakes, like you know how they shade where people are being quoted,
and hilarious.
They don't match.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like it looks
so bad,
a little thrown together. I know it looks a little thrown together, but it's great and it's super honest.
Look like paper towel rolls.
They shouldn't have shown the replay because that.
Oh, all right. There you go.
Mike Sharp versus Tito Santana.
Santana accepts. Wow.
Hey, and you know what? Tito Santana, a friend of the show and supporter of the Tops, recently Tito just announced his retirement from 40 years of teaching in New Jersey. And so congratulations.
Ah, that's awesome. Mm. Yeah, great to hear. Good for him. I'm sure it's well earned.
Oh, that music.
So we're going to end the evening with back-to-back matches from Puerto Rico. That's Sheiky Star, who a famous, well, at the time he was the most hated man in Puerto Rico.
Oh, Sheiky Star is awesome.
And of course, now we're going to have a big match. Iron Sheik and Carlos Colon.
And this is after he gets fired by the WWF, but before WWE.
And this is where he is also 8 months pregnant, as you can see.
He's got a belly button the size of a fucking apricot.
Look at it. Oh my God.
It's so gross. He was an innie who became an outie. What's the Total Recall?
Or like Krang and the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. His belly button's more over than him in Puerto Rico. And I'll tell you something, he's got a big, huge wrestling fans. They call him Fanaticos in Puerto Rico. But let me tell you something, the Iron Sheik is a man that deserves to be respected. 4 Olympic gold medals, Ugo Stavinovich. 4 Olympic gold medals.
Oh, God. What bullshit. 4 Olympic gold medals.
Lucky. He hit some garbage out of midair there. That was awesome.
0 Olympic gold medals.
He was thinking the audience when 4 gold medals were won. So, you know.
I mean, he competed in the Olympics, but he didn't.
that kid thought he was part of the entry.
Oh, he didn't even make it to the Olympics? Okay.
I think he physically got there. But
kids. Nobody's. Wow. That's right. Now he's going to conquer the Iron Sheik. You notice Carlos Colon's going to conquer the youngster Carlos Colon, Denise.
Yeah, of course.
You know what's so fucking stupid that people still think Gorilla was being dumb and calling him a youngster?
Yeah.
When it was clearly a rib.
Yeah, right. Because they've known each other forever.
Yeah, Jesus Christ.
Oh, yeah, because, Carlos started in New York in the 60s.
You know, we covered up a murder or two. So, Carlos and I.
Gorilla co-owned the.
We haven't seen a red striped referee since the New Year's Eve show. Way back when.
Yeah, that's the problem when you go on vacation. I went on vacation in Jamaica once, and it's nothing but red stripe referees. So by the time you leave, you can never have another red stripe referee again around you. It's the only person that could say that, Bobby, because all the fans have seen the way. That was quite the experience while we were down there. What do you want to drink? A beer? What do you got? Red stripe. Do you have anything else? Yeah. Nope. Nope.
In the stubbies.
All right.
Yeah.
Red stripe.
I've never had one of those in like 20 years. I can't remember if it was good or bad.
No, there's.
It was fine.
They're not too bad.
It was fine, but by the time that vacation was done, wanted another one again.
Carlos Colon is really fired. He is really fired. Never again.
This guy in the hat. We've been seeing a lot of good hats. This guy, the head of ringside, taking pictures.
There's a couple of them.
Winston Cigarettes are the sponsor. Is this a stadium? This is a stadium.
This is indoors.
Indoors,
I'm pretty sure. I don't think it's outdoors.
By his kidneys.
It's hard to tell for sure, but I think it's indoors. Cool.
My fucking balls are falling out, man. Jesus.
Got the drawstrings.
Let me tie my belly button. It's come undone. Quato is about to come.
He's trying to get it. You're going to get me disqualified, buddy. Take it easy. Oh, I didn't see that. I was looking for Sheiky Star. I didn't really see Sheik's drawstrings. Drawstrings. I think that's what you mistaken for. Guy looks like Eddie Graham.
Sheiky Star?
No, the guy. Yeah, yeah.
His manager?
Yeah.
We know the year for this? 87, 88?
80, I'm pretty sure it's 87. Ric Flair for the NWA world
title. He took Flair the limit many times, as you know. Who's on commentary here? Do we know?
The play-by-play guy is Hugo Savanovich, who is a long-time Puerto Rican commentator. The English guy or the English or the whatever North American guy, American, I guess. I'm not sure who it was. He was a wrestler, though. I forget his name.
Whatever happened to Alvarico? We haven't heard from him in a while.
Yeah, I don't know. He's not. He hasn't been on PWO in forever.
It'd be fun to do a Puerto Rico-centric show.
He's a walking encyclopedia of Puerto Rican wrestling history.
I haven't been on PWO in years.
Well, you're not missing much.
I got mad at some of the comments directed years ago. Well, I used to pick on poor Parf too much.
Pick on poor old Parf. Yeah, well, Parf brought it on himself.
He brought a lot.
Yeah.
No, I think what actually dropped it for me was getting called a perv because I wrote a thread on Trish Stratus. All right, guys. We're done here, guys. You can go back and watch it just All Japan for the rest of your lives.
PWO nowadays is mostly just modern WWE AEW talk, at least in the main threads, main folders. We have a jam-packed house,
abdominal stretch here. That's right. And the Iron Sheik, this announcer's rad. Wow, yeah. You know somebody's...
Travis, I definitely want to talk to you about Boom, because I had some questions from what I watched.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, my God.
Nice. Maybe this is not the best time. Yeah. Crazy.
Boot camp match, slaughter feed style. Gusher. Usually it's Carlitos who's a bloody mess.
Right. It's still early, I feel.
Yeah,
Carlos Colon is somebody I've just never been able to get into.
Really?
I haven't watched the Hanson series.
Amazing. And a lot of the happy Abdullah matches are really good.
The happy matches what we saw in Lords of the Ring are fucking insane.
He was Dylan Hales on PWO years ago, compared him to Jerry Lawler in Memphis, and it's a very apt comparison. Yeah, if you like bloodbaths, I mean, he's your man. He's one of the blood feuds, just like Hercules Alea. They have a crazy feud that culminates in a fire ring match that's actually not that bad from what I remember.
Well, it stems from, I don't remember what they were called. Maybe you guys, I don't know if I had them in Canada, but my local library in the mid 80s had a couple of books. I want to say it was wasn't George Napolitano wrote it. I was going to say Bert Sugar was involved for some reason, but it was two picture books on wrestling with
articles. Yeah, it was Napolitano. I had both of them.
Napolitano wrote them. Okay. And
one was the good, the bad, and the ugly.
She had no objection to me watching the WF, but when she saw a picture of Carlos and Abby bleeding, she's like, God, no, we're not crying again.
They had full color blood photos. Because one was wrestling's, it was like an all feuds, like the best feuds or whatever. I forget the exact title. And then the other one was the good, the bad, and the ugly.
That's right. Yeah,
I remember I got them both on the same day because they were in like a discount bin by that point.
Jesus. This has had a real different energy from anything we've seen from Sheik so far. Fuck, of course.
Yeah. Work the cut.
Yeah. We got our season finale June 30th, Robert.
Oh, really?
For Boom, yeah. We wrote it all, or we tried to book it all like a season of television. You know, we had these 9 dates, and you know, people, we were we knew who we had for long term, so we could kind of do a strong skeleton of what we were going to do for those 9 shows. We've had to rebook on the fly a lot of the time in spite of that.
Especially at the beginning.
But also even now, you'd be surprised what's going on behind the scenes these days. What kind of questions did you have, young Robert?
How did you, One of them you answered for me, actually, which was, well, I think sort of you did, which I was curious what the building was and what if you guys were the only thing they did there like that, and how much of the equipment was yours?
Well, lighting. We've become, like, we're kind of getting, or Max is getting offered to kind of, Jimmy, offered free booking through the Legion, yeah, or this section, this spot, because it's a bigger building. And yes, as Johnny's saying in the chat, on the bottom, there's a spot where just a place where old dudes can get drunk, and there's another section where we had my 40th birthday a while back,
private room,
and then, and yeah, which is a private room and has its own bar, and then there's this room that Max has discovered, or that we just discovered as being great, and
a ballroom, basically.
Yeah. And we might get to keep, that's what you were saying. Okay, that,
but
that
it's an old building. Like, it must go back to when, the 40s or 50s?
It's
Canadian
got,
Legion,
yeah.
Yeah, it's got a great metal back of the building stairs to walk up and enter from the back, and also hang out and smoke. Is that, that was the, that was where we smoked.
Yeah, and like then the people that are go to the bar, like it's got a pretty solid locals crowd of people that have been going there for 30, 40 years.
Which is fucking great because, yeah, it's your typical Canadian Legion, American Legion. I mean, you know what a Legion is like. And it's smack dab in what you would call the cool part of town, I would imagine. At least.
Yeah.
It's a different area. Yeah,
and it's the historical Little Italy neighborhood too.
Okay, to me that's the cool part of it. Like again, Kelly said it again. When we walked up and down the streets before the show, I was just like, God, I want to just fucking hang out here for a fucking.
Yeah, I thought you'd like it. Yeah, it's got a great vibe.
I would eat at like six different places and go into a million incredible stores.
Yeah.
There we go.
But there are honestly, Johnny, there's like three or four neighborhoods like that right now.
It's a giant city that's known for being hipster. I get it. Yeah. But that one that I experienced, okay, especially the Little Italy part. That really works for me.
Ha, rad.
The only
you
should add pizza that one
place. We've talked about
it. Find you some good pizza. Yeah, we'll find you some good pizza.
Hey, yeah. I'm coming back.
Best pizza in Vancouver is probably on commercial.
When season two? I'm gonna come back, man.
I'll show you the dates.
Yeah, fuck!
Woo!
Look at Carlos's lit up. Carlos.
That young spry Carlos.
Yeah. Yes, the youngster. The youngster. Carlos Colon.
I don't know, dude. This looks like a fucking stadium to me.
Great heated comebacks.
Right.
Yeah, I think you're right.
No, maybe those lights are too high, maybe. I don't know.
They always did.
Wherever they are is fucking huge.
Tons of shows in baseball stadiums.
That's what it probably is. It's probably a baseball stadium.
But usually,
speaking of which, Little League, my Little League team is lost our first two games. First wasn't great, but got good. Second one was a down to the last fucking run.
Rats
8-9.
I want you guys to run the table. I want a year where
we have all the potential to, but it has been the rainiest spring, early summer in Colorado in the longest time. Half of our practices have been rained out. We had two games this week rained out. It has been nonstop rain here. But when they get to play again, we have two pitchers who just fucking are the heat.
Who is this?
Is that Hugo?
Hugo's on the right.
Yeah.
I forget the wrestler's name.
It's not that. No, it's not.
He's got the same sausage fingers that the aforementioned Prince Charles has. Prince Charles' sausage hands are the grossest things you've ever seen.
There's a lot of gross about that fucking inbred fucking moron.
And now that's part of the boombox.
He's got a whip. Who the fuck is this guy?
I don't know, but he does commentary on all of these
shows.
Well, there was a bunch of tapes. They put out a
make sure
ton
to
of
check out
tapes.
Bobby Jaggers, Denise's
guest. I see Yeah. I was about to say Bobby Jaggers.
Yeah, it is Jaggers. Yeah, yeah.
It's Jaggers. All right. Mm-hmm. I was gonna say that, but I'm used to Bobby Jaggers with a beard.
Yep.
Yeah.
I like this a lot. This is like a bonus level in there Super Mario Brothers.
Bobby Jaggers. Yeah, yeah. Right, Hangman Bobby Jaggers.
Okay. Do you ever have like a weird team that just existed for a bit that you liked for some dumb reason that didn't get over? In Crockett in late 86.
The Kansas Jayhawks.
Yeah.
I remember Bobby reading Jaggers, about them and Dutch
Bobby
Mantel.
Jaggers and Dutch Mantel.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I fucking loved the Kansas Jayhawks.
Which is the name of the university, the basketball or the sports teams.
Yeah, they're named after the basketball team.
Yeah.
Well done, Denise. Yeah. Denise historianed us all.
Nice.
Well, research. Here we go. This is our main event.
Classic match. I know Travis and I have seen this before. I know we watched at your place, Travis, years ago.
Right.
The Norman. It's basically War Games. It's two rings. Dage. Yeah. Abby's in it. We're gonna see Brody.
Wow.
Of course.
Give me my
Sheik and Carlos. That's in my contract. Yeah. That's crazy that.
Look, we had to sell the steps a few weeks ago, people.
Yeah, they had to sell the Bruno. Steps. To pay.
Well, I'm taking these with me.
There's a roof on the cage. The Sheik pawned the fucking stairs for Coke.
Why is there a third ring?
Yeah, maybe the regular matches? I don't know. That's
Mr. Victor Quinones. Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Oh,
look at this. This is wild.
Guess you have to set the cage up at the start.
Look at this, dude. People fucking sitting like that on the fucking...
Crazy.
Hanging on. That's fucking wild.
Yeah.
So
the rules are safe.
Yeah, maybe. You have to handcuff your opponents to the cage one by one to eliminate them.
What? They did that at Smoky Mountain, I think. That was
you're right.
That's the angle that finally started.
Straight for the balls.
So that's Chicky Star.
Yeah. I'm out of here. I can't get out. Let me out. This guy's trying to destroy my balls.
Is that the first cage I think I've ever seen with that kind of, with that tall, with that kind of roof?
This is wild. So there are so many health regulations being broken right now, I'm sure.
Yeah, just by that guy standing by the Miller sign alone, like 13.
So, of course, it looks like War Games, but in Spanish, this match is known as the Great War.
Okay, so I'm trying to figure out everyone else in here. Was that TNT?
Savio Vega, TNT is
TNT,
in it.
TNT, Savio Vega, okay.
With the face paint.
Looking cool.
I'm not sure who's in the mask.
Is that Carlos again?
Yeah, Carlos, of course.
And Abby, yeah.
Yeah.
And Sheik. And that's Dutch Mantel. There's Dutch.
That is Dutch, yeah.
Out of the Kansas Jayhawks.
First round draft pick.
Dutch Mantel. Kansas State.
From the University of Kansas.
University of Kansas.
Point guard. Yeah.
Point guard.
Oh, by the way, they just did a four-part 30 for 30 on ESPN on Bill Walton.
On the Mets? Oh,
Bill Walton. No, Bill, a new one on Bill Walton.
Parts, really?
And believe me, there's never been this much Grateful Dead music on ESPN ever, because it's the soundtrack of all 4 hours. It's fucking great.
That's crazy.
I've seen Bill at Dead and Company shows. Hmm. You can't miss him.
Right.
Well, yeah, he's 7'7". Two.
I mean, he's a little, maybe not quite 7 because of all his back surgeries, but you'll look out in the crowd and we go, okay, there's a giant over there with gray hair. Walton's here.
I'm tired, Johnny. For a second there, I just thought you said Bill Watts. I said, wait, what?
Yeah, Bill Watts. He's been following the dead, too.
4-part, 30 for 30, definitely.
Bill Watts is a noted deadhead. You didn't know that?
definitely.
I mean, dude, he like smoked a lot of weed. Love the dead.
All right.
I ran into Watts at plenty of shows. Yeah, we just, you just never talked about it. Is that Norman, the big guy?
No, okay. It's not Mukka Singh.
Mantar, maybe?
Mantar? Who was Who was it? I don't know. What was
his name? Steve Williams? Is it not Dr. Death?
No, it's not Dr. Death.
Dr. Death wasn't.
I'm going to try and figure this out.
Oh, I'm looking at this guy. Oh, no, I'm confusing Dutch.
Igaia. He's calling him Igaia.
Oh, is it Hercules Ayala?
Yeah, it's probably Ayala. Yeah, that's who it is. It's Hercules Ayala.
That leg drop was fucking incredible.
I don't even know what the rules are.
Who's red and blue there?
You fight. Those are the rules.
Who, the mask guy? Travis?
No. There's the guy who's in the corner.
Savio
Vega.
TNT is.
TNT.
No, like he's getting beat up, but that's TNT. Okay.
No, that's TNT in the black. The Iron Sheik is wearing blue.
Who's getting beat up in the corner right now?
There's like this guy.
Chicky Star. That's a guy I don't know. Ayala.
I'm not sure who the guy who just got handcuffed is.
That's Ayala.
It's Ayala.
But then who's the really fat? Is that the fast guy?
I don't know.
Okay, Grizzly. Okay, Grizzly Boone is.
Grizzly Boone. I think it's a madhouse, Robert. It's a madhouse.
Grizzly Boone's the big boy. The one that Johnny thought was Norman.
All right.
We call
Kelly Bright Eyes on this planet.
Invader One is the mask. It's
Invader. Got it. There we go.
God, I should have known that.
So Invader and Brody are in the same fucking ring, huh? All right.
Okay. Murder Brody.
All right.
Crazy.
You know what? I like it.
Jose Gonzalez. Crazy. He's better known as.
That's wild.
But yeah, I should have known it was one of the invaders.
My friend Dave for our podcast did a little bit of research. Do you know you could actually book him in Puerto Rico for birthday parties?
Oh my god.
Who the invader?
Jose Gonzalez.
Okay, yeah. Does he can you get him to stab a pinata shaped like
an extra $100 to stab a pinata Bruiser Brody?
Yeah.
Too soon.
It's full of probably. God, it's full of fucking red fucking Kool-Aid. Who thought this was a good idea for a children's party?
What would be the best candy?
I'm starting to go
on another $100 and Tony
Twizzlers.
Atlas will be
it's just Twizzlers. Twizzlers just falls out.
TNT has been handcuffed. He's out of it.
Red vines just spill up.
The show WWE, it was a backlash they did in Puerto Rico when fucking Savio Vega came out. That fucking place exploded.
That's pretty awesome. That made me
so happy.
Yeah.
So happy.
Yeah, no, he's a legend. Cool. Oh,
man. Hey, Absolute Aaron. Thanks for joining us, pal.
Poor guy, he's bed handcuffed and he's getting ball shotted double team.
Yes. Well, I'm out. Dude, I'm out. I'm out. Time out. I've been eliminated.
Totally helpless. Dude,
with everyone, this is where Gorilla Monsoon hung out in here a lot with him and his, illegitimate kid, right?
Yeah.
So this is where he literally got the hanging from the rafters line. They were literally hanging from the rafters in Havana.
Abby and Carlos.
Havana. The eternal war.
There's so many balls. Is it who booked this? Bruce Hart? All the balls shot.
He was doing while he was subbing for you guys. He was on the phone during the first period. Right.
Yeah. He takes credit for it, but you know.
Right.
Side hustle in Puerto Rico booking.
Who is this the same announcer from the previous?
Yeah, it's the same.
Yeah, he's awesome, man.
Ivanovic and Bobby Jaggers.
Yeah.
I know, he's like a soccer announcer, the goal.
Yeah, yeah.
Announcer.
That's why, Jesus. Oh, just balls.
Okay, Travis, speaking...
The children in the front row. Balls.
Travis, speaking... I heard you mention, speaking of the Lords of the Ring, which is available on our Patreon. Thank you to everyone who's joined our Patreon. And
including our guest tonight.
Thank you, Robert.
Thanks,
Do you remember during that Carlos Colon Abby clip from Starcade with that great referee fucking bump?
Unbelievable.
Someone runs into the ring and hits Carlos Colon and Gordon Sully has no idea who he is. That's Hugo Savinovich, this announcer.
Yeah, because he was a heel manager originally.
All I want to know is, Travis, is what's the tier level to get you guys to do Giant Panda from DDT? How much do I have to cough up?
Any, that's chicken feed, man. Come on. You got to go a lot further than that. We'll do that. We'll do that next week, bro. We'll preempt Canada Day.
That's actually now the favorite.
Basically,
the highest tier we review the China one where she does Mean Gene and whoever.
Oh, dude, we have to review the China porno. We have to review the China porno. Okay. The Ric Flair actor from that was our What a Maneuver logo.
Right. Yeah.
The logo on our show was porno Ric Flair.
Oh, that's. Oh my god.
No, I do have to like all of our first New York trilogy that we did, including the last Brawl to End It All. I've got a I'll probably start making that available in June here. Or
hey, I got an idea. Speaking of What a Maneuver, and I'll have to try to contact Jack Miller. But I'm not saying whole shows, but there are bits that I could edit out that maybe we could throw up on there that are really fucking funny. Cool. Yeah, no 2-hour shows with our ad breaks and reviewing SmackDown, but we do have a few legendary fucking bits.
This is funny how everyone's still like handcuffed and trying to get involved. It's fucking hilarious.
Brody, Brody just trying to touch
the fuzzy boots.
I haven't seen this many men handcuffed to cages since.
Wait a minute, Johnny. You spent time in Philly. I ain't buying that one.
I was going to say I was spending time in San Francisco at a bathhouse that had very specific, you know, fetishes.
Come on, give me your hand. It's my night. It's my night.
He belongs in fucking handcuffs. He's a goddamn murderer.
If only they knew at that moment they had him.
We let him go.
If Sheiky baby knew. I mean, who knows?
Now's your chance, Bruiser.
I fuck him in ass for you, Bruiser.
Jesus.
Oh, no.
Once, it doesn't feel quite like the real thing, but once Sheiky gets going, it's good enough.
Carlos is going to be carved up.
Yeah. Are these the last two?
I think so. Abby.
Looks like it.
Yeah, Abby's still. No,
Abby's trying to reach. This is so weird. So bizarre. Nobody's in the other ring. Imagine if there's just one other guy, like, hey, what? Just kind of sitting there, like a goalie. Like a goalie watching a bench clearing brawl on the other side.
Who's the manager? He looks like one of the Globetrotters.
I don't know. Muhammad Ali.
It's so funny they all ended up in the one ring. This
is the Great War. The Great War.
Where Matt Hardy got the idea.
Right. They did theirs years later.
That's actually a funny time I tried to have you killed by Karrion Kross at Matt Hardy. Still working on that one, by the way. When he gets to WWE, he's going to be the new super. I actually had a plan to.
We almost made it through this whole thing without you mentioning Karrion Kross murdering me, Robert.
You're doing a goofy thing. <you bring. laughs> And there's Karrion Kross in the ring.
You're just out to get me beat up by Karrion Kross.
But the worst part about it was that, I mean, you'd think I'd want to at least watch one of my best friends get beat up by Karrion Kross or by a wrestler, but I change the channel every time fucking Karrion Kross is up. I won't even watch the news report. Yeah. You get beat up by Karrion Kross.
Wow, he did it. And then they're just like leaning into him.
Yeah, this is one of the great beatdowns of all time.
And he's letting out his boys.
Victor, go the spoils.
Jesus Christ. I heard the Sheiky's hands shaking.
And each of them get, is that part of the thing? You get 5 minutes of it with the bag?
Yeah, the heels one. Yeah.
Is Avi a baby face in this?
Yes.
He is?
That's
or
weird.
Or is he? I don't know.
I don't know. He's maybe not setting not. Him free.
Yeah, no. Abby's not a baby. Brody's the baby.
Okay. Abby's trying to help by holding his hand.
Holding him down.
I got him. I got him. He's not going anywhere. Shane.
Go to work, bro. Like, fuck you for that. Hey, man. He's still okay.
Grizzly Boone's free.
What a mess.
Jesus Christ. How the fuck did I get into this?
Let's get the belt. We've seen a lot of belt whipping tonight.
Yeah, dude, that's why I'm fucking... I blasted three times in my fucking pants.
Yeah, all right.
Uh-huh.
Wow, there's still... This match is over. There's still 8 minutes left in this video.
It's like the inside of a... It's like the inside of a Krispy Kreme here, Travis.
Greatest beatdowns of all time.
Jesus Christ. Using a belt buckle.
The rape of Carlos Colon.
He's adding another fucking gouge.
Yeah. I want you to remember this is my stripe. This is Sheiky's stripe. Right down the middle.
I got you, baby. I got you.
Don't worry. He's not going anywhere, bud.
How'd you guys find out about this match? I mean, I found it, but you guys have seen it before. How'd you find out about this?
This was Dylan on PWO years ago. He was pimping Puerto Rico matches, and that's where I discovered it. So it's one of the better threads ever on PWO.
Dylan's one of the better people to come out of the internet because, I mean, God, you meet a lot of real, maybe not so stable people.
I don't know what you're talking about, John.
I have a litany of them.
Well, by the speaking of that, Johnny, I just wanted to say, because I included a few words on him on my latest episode of my show, but your tribute to Dean Rasmussen was amazing. Really well
done. Oh, thanks, man. Yeah. Thank you. I appreciate that, man. Not one of the crazy ones, by the way. Right, okay. One of the good ones. Oh, a little slow-mo for this? Or is that your YouTube?
I think that was the internet stalling.
Oh, okay, because right. I liked it. Now I like this. I like the fast motion, too. He wants to put the camel clutch
on Carlito's cologne. Just when you thought it couldn't get worse for Carlos, it does.
Thank God I'm out of there. No! Right into the...
But they seem like kind of calm over all this.
People are literally
these kids just like kind of kicking their legs and stuff.
These kids are gonna start leaping off of that fucking balcony onto the top of the any second right now.
Punching through the top. We gotta get the bruiser out of there, you guys.
Oh, here we go. Oh, this shit was shoddily made. Bruiser Brody is very upset. Look at this. Huh. Apparently.
Now we get the cherry on the top of the beatdown is the Sheiky Star kicks.
Because everyone fucking hates. I would also, you guys and everyone who's watching this on YouTube or whatever, and all of our fine Patreon people,
Sheiky Star.
Look up Sheiky Star videos. He was a heat fucking machine. In Puerto Rico, and is amazing. There's so much good Sheiky Star shit.
I've never even heard the name, man. It's so
one
cool.
of the great scaffold matches of all time is him and Invader number 3.
A contradiction in terms, but no, we covered it on my podcast. It is great.
His heel group is known as the Sports Club. Sheiky Star's Sports Club.
That's great.
Uh-huh. They put the flag on Carlos.
Because you know how the Puerto Ricans and fucking Iran.
Yeah.
The war between Puerto Rico and Iran was a bloody and long one.
Hey, they're part of America. They're Americans, baby.
Yeah. I know. Okay.
I know that most Americans don't remember that or realize it because they're racist fucking fuckhead.
I remember
most non-Americans don't know that.
I remember your former president was kind enough to throw some paper towels.
Yeah, I mean, he showed you how much he cared, right?
He was kind of like the Roddy Piper of Puerto Rico, Denise says.
I threw him the paper towels. Sheiky, I threw him the paper towels. People in New York, they like them when I throw the paper towels. I throw the paper towels at Bounty. Jeez, Bounty's good. It's a quicker picker upper. Quicker picker upper. I throw them and they give me a garbage bag.
It's no Dreyfus, Johnny.
That's not Dreyfus. That's my fucking.
I said it's no Dreyfus.
Hey, you know what? That's how you do Trump. You do Trump with like, I don't know.
I disagree.
No, you believe
I've
me.
I've seen you nail Dreyfus.
Well, I know I need to work on it, but you don't need to go over the top, Trump. You need to do quiet, subdued, Trump. The bad boys tape. You finally get to
see who's really bad. Hercules. So, was there a follow up to this? What was?
Yeah, I not that yep. I could find online.
Machine guns in the middle of a fucking baseball stadium.
Get revenge, decapitation.
That's crazy. No, this was it. This was their go home show. Like everything wrapped up.
I wasn't sure if the previous match we watched came before this or after it.
Oh man, they're tearing down the turnbuckles too.
But I thought we had to end with this because it's an all time classic.
Yeah. Now the refs and wrestlers are coming in to help.
Finally over. Look at Carlos.
I know he's the
just
one
just get
got
the body bag out.
Yeah. Zip. Yeah. Invader's reacting, but a little too late.
Some heat back. Yeah.
I haven't seen this much blood since the premonition I had. Hey, Brody, come here.
They were on the same side. Oh, fuck.
Wow, crazy.
You know what? You're gonna pay me for tonight? Yeah. Well, I'll meet you in the shower. Meet you in the shower.
Just the hot dogs, hombre.
That'd be a curious thing. How close is this to Bruce?
Yeah, just no signs of life.
He's dead. This man is dead.
Carlos Colon was beaten to death in the middle of
Brody,
two rings.
Bruiser Brody knows how to take your pulse. Apparently, it's grab your hand and shake it a little. I think this motherfucker's dead.
All right. Oh, yeah, we got a minute and 10 seconds to go. Thank you again, Robert. Another really fun show.
Thanks, man.
I love this. You guys, this is the best. Hopefully, no one's going to die in the next 2 weeks. So we can just.
I know, because this is turning into a fucking, death podcast.
Well, they come in threes usually. So.
But I think we should make it Canadian centric,
especially
if Johnny's
going to die in the next
2 weeks. Well, I hate to say this, but they were both WWF champions. So if I'm Hulk Hogan or Bob Backlund, I'm getting nervous.
You're right. Backlund, possibility.
Okay, hold on a second. Who is murdering all of the WWF?
Yeah, it's a watchman. It's a watchman.
The great chefs of Europe.
Yeah, that's true.
Probably Greg Gagne.
Even think of that.
It's Greg Gagne. Of course it's Greg Gagne. Columbo.
Revenge, finally.
Hilarious. Well, rest in peace, Carlos Colon. On this day.
He came back on the third day.
The Sheik fucking rocks. This was great. Thanks again, everybody. Johnny, have a good time in 2 weeks. I'm sure you
Thank
will.
Thank you, sir.
And we'll put together something, like I said, kind of Canadian-centric as we're seeing more of the...
And 90 minutes, you should take your time if you haven't watched this before. Yeah,
so good. Anyways,
and again, thank you to all the people who subscribe to Patreon and spread the word and give us more of your money. Thanks.
Yeah, more to come, my friends. We'll see you.